for it.
For it. 70,000 in Kinnick Stadium are ready for it. You're watching a presentation of the Big Ten on ABC. 27th meeting in this series. Penn State's won the last three to claim a 14-12 lead. Weird, Kirk, over the years, the road team has actually fared better than the home team. Road teams combined 15-11 in this series. First visit for James Franklin ever. These current Lions were not on the team in 2012, and Bill O'Brien came here in his first year and won. Saquon Barkley has taken over kick return duties. Penn State won the toss, a little bit uncharacteristically chose to take the football. So we'll see number 26 in this new role this season.
Interesting, James Franklin on the road in this environment, instead of deferring and kind of going the safe way, he wants that football.
Miguel Recinos to boot it away. He will drive the ball deep, and Barkley will take a knee. And here comes that explosive Penn State offense led by Trace McSorley.
And McSorley tonight, big thing for him on the road. Be a great compliment running the football. He has a big arm, but he can run the ball. And you got to take some of the attention off of Barkley. Also, take advantage when you create the one-on-ones on the outside. And the last thing, this is where his experience comes into play. He's become a veteran. Just kind of manage that road environment. Deal with this crowd. Make great decisions, which you would expect him to do based on the way he played last year and the early part of this year.
Lions have not really been tested, blasting Akron, beating Pitt, and then manhandling Georgia State. First road game. McSorley rolling and flips it to Barkley in the flat, who makes it cut. And gets out across the 30. They'll see him active in the pass game tonight.
Yeah, that's the area that he's probably improved the most since you and I last saw him. That Rose Bowl game was just epic against USC. He had such a great night. But if you can improve, you got to improve somewhere. He wanted to improve in becoming a better receiver. And he's definitely done that in these first three games.
Penn State very good on first down. He gets six there. And now it's Barkley's first carry. And he muscles across the 35 for a first down.
Yeah, you're Iowa and defensive coordinator Phil Parker. Your big thing here is not to give up the big play. In fact, their defense is designed not to give up the big play. They're one of the best teams in the country a year ago in doing that. And you want to make McSorley and of course, Saquon Barkley have to earn it. Don't give up the big play, which is what Penn State has thrived on in the last 13 games.
Barkley again. Gets around the edge. Dangerous speed. A flag comes out as Barkley is bumped out in Iowa territory by Imani Hooker. But this one, I think, is going to come back.
It may be a hold here on DeAndre Tompkins, the wide receiver. I was wondering how he got outside and got the edge. Rugumba, the corner,
holding.
Looked like he got held.
Offense number three. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
John O'Neill leading this Big Ten crew. Lions receivers block very well, but an obvious penalty there. So instead of being in Iowa territory, ball moved back to the 31.
Eddie, the corner wants to be able to keep that edge to this defense. You cannot let him get outside. Now look how he's getting held right there by Tompkins. That's what allows Barkley to bounce it outside.
Miles Sanders spelling Barkley to the left of McSorley now in the backfield. You fake it to him, and from the pocket, a sack. Quick pressure by Anthony Nelson, the sophomore defensive end.
Boy, he had such length and great quickness. Keep in mind, Chris, 6'7", 260 pounds, but with his quickness, he's able to come off Andrew Nelson and get around the corner with that length. See the arms? He kind of uses his momentum to pull 59 Nelson by him, and that's how he was able to collapse that pocket. That's a heck of a play.
Second and 18. McSorley flips it to Sanders out of the backfield, makes one man miss, but the pursuit gets him for just a short gain. Bo Bauer and Josie Jewell combined.
Great word you just said, pursuit. That has been reinforced over and over this week. And leverage on the football. That time an outstanding job by this defense. Starts with the corner, forcing it back inside. And when he forced it back inside, there's three black jerseys there to bring down Sanders.
Third down, a serious problem for Penn State last year. A little bit better this year. Still not where they want it to be. And they need 12 as the crowd comes in. Barkley back in the game. McSorley gets good protection, delivers across the middle, and the catch is made by Barkley, who's down right near the marker. He stumbled on this newly installed turf here, and the spot's going to be very close.
They're going to give him the first down. That looked just like our open, what he did against Pitt. How about this against a linebacker? And we talked about, can Josie Jewell match up with him, especially on third down? They had some man principles underneath. That's what created that big opening. Boy, they gave him that first down despite where, at least based on where our mark was, looked like he may have been at least maybe a measurement, right?
I thought they might buzz down. We had so many spots reviewed last week. Yeah. Louisville, four of them in the first half. They don't review this one. And now McSorley, he's an excellent scrambler. Can gain lots of yards with his legs, and he scoots out at the 42 after picking up 12.
Talk about trying to keep a guy in the pocket. This time, Nelson gets a little bit too wide, and by going out wide like that, look at this right here, creates a nice little lane for him to step into. He had his eyes downfield, but with all the coverage going downfield, their backs turned to him. There's the savvy by McSorley, that understanding of when to pull it down and take off. He's one of these guys that wants to make the throw, but when it's open like that, why not take the first down?
Sure, he's averaged 6 yards a run this season. Eighth play of the drive, a quarterback keeper. They had Barkley very well defended, but McSorley shows some toughness and gets to the 35.
When you're the best player in the country, and I think he is the best player, and you give just a little shoulder fake like we're going to pitch it out to 26, three or four black jerseys are flying out there because they've been hearing about 26 and stopping him all week long, and that time they cut right underneath that, and you'll take 7 or 8 yards every time on first down.
Barkley, and he's going to be corralled by Josie Jewell. Looking forward to collisions between those two team leaders all night.
I can't wait to watch this throughout tonight. 43 against 26, and it's the instincts. And watch how he fits. Watch how he finds a little crease here. That's just, you really can't coach that. That's a linebacker feeling it, reading his keys, but slipping a block and getting into the backfield to be able to come up with that play. 26 white against 43 black all night is going to be a great matchup.
You see Jewell huffing and puffing there, and Lions need four on third down. Barkley motions out. McSorley looks that way. He's got it on the edge. Can he fight through two tacklers? No. Amani Hooker drives him out 2 yards short. It'll be fourth down.
That's a win for Iowa's defense, although fourth down doesn't necessarily mean they're going to punt. They're kind of in that no-man territory where you consider going for it, and that's exactly what they're going to do.
Tyler Davis is the kicker. This would be beyond his career long. He can get it there, but Franklin on the road, gambling early. Highlight the tight end, Mike Gesicki, who's the leading receiver on this team, number 88.
And in these kind of situations, he is a tough matchup for any defense.
Play clock at five. Must hurry. Did not get it off. Did not get it off. I think there's a whistle before. It's a delay of game. A flag came out.
Prior to the play, delay of game. Offense. 5 yard penalty. Fourth down.
I think the crowd and even the Iowa team thinks the offense is out on the field. We've got to punt the football. I think everybody's going to be a little bit surprised.
It was plenty loud. You could hear the same way. You didn't hear the whistle. The flag came out. see McSorley trying to direct traffic, get Gesicki in motion.
Yeah, delay. And a lot of their plays are called predicated upon what alignment you're in defensively. So there, when you have a guy like Trace McSorley, he's able to recognize and see the last look that you're in and make the call, whether it's a run or a pass.
More of an Iowa-like vibe than Penn State style, Kirk. 10 plays, 36 yards. They chew up 5.5, and now Blake Gilligan will try to pin the Hawkeyes deep. Josh Jackson, who's one of the starting corners, is the punt returner, standing at his 6. Gilligan, the sophomore, high, short boot, and a fair catch is made at the 9-yard line. So Iowa takes over its first possession, pinned back, scoreless in the first quarter. Taco Bell, proud partner of the College Football Playoff, so be on the lookout for the Taco Bell student sections. Passionate fans like these all season long. They're passionate about their team. In Iowa City, they are very passionate about their tailgating as well. They take a backseat to very few pregame preparation.
We got a good view of that. Coming on over here. Midseason form, right?
Here's Nate Stanley, who won the quarterback job in a close competition. He was the backup to C.J. Beathard. He's a sophomore from Wisconsin. Got a big arm. Overcame some nerves early in the season. He's calmed down a lot. He's beating Akram Wadley, and the Hawkeyes have a big play explosive back as well.
Yeah, Akram Wadley, who last week got a little bit in the doghouse, high-stepped into the end zone and cost him a touchdown, then had a little bit of a slight ankle situation and went into the locker room. And glad to see him back this week.
That's kind of an unnecessary call. He kind of gave it a little dead
leg. It was really
come
bad.
On. Yeah. Let him play, officials.
That wasn't that bad at all.
Got a yard on first down. Stanley from the pocket. Fires over the middle. Overthrown. Airmailed it to Matt Vandenberg, the veteran receiver who missed almost all of last year with a foot injury and is back for a fifth year.
Penn State has 8 guys up at the line of scrimmage. They're basically coming into this game saying Nate Stanley is still a young guy, a little bit unproven. Let's see if he can win this game, and let's load up against Wadley in this running game. But he felt some pressure there. Penn State just about got to him.
Been an adrenaline overthrow there.
Yeah,
with his first
early, just kind of feeling it. But Sharif Miller, who's wearing 19 tonight.
He's honoring Torrance Brown. Yeah, he's got a knee injury. And
he got in there.
He lost for the year. So Wadley is the back on 3rd and 9. Lions bring some pressure again. Stanley delivers over the middle. It's incomplete. That was Noah Fant, their fine tight end. Wasn't turned and looked for the ball, and it's a 3-and-out for the Hawkeyes.
Yeah, when Iowa is going to have success tonight, they're going to have success on 1st and 10 to get them where they can dictate things a little bit. When you're gaining a yard on 1st and 10 and you get the 2nd and 9 and 3rd and 9, that's not Iowa's wheelhouse, especially with a quarterback that's still kind of getting settled in.
So the punter is Colton Rastetter. He's a lefty, sophomore, first-year punter. DeAndre Tompkins is a dangerous returner for Penn State, and he waves for a fair catch, and Penn State will take over in Iowa territory at the 45 after a 35-yard punt.
Saturday Night Football on ABC is presented by Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo, building better every day. In part by Allstate, official protector of college football fans. At Nissan, innovation that excites.
Those are some tough, brave, and resilient people. Some of the patients. The Iowa Children's Hospital, it's a beautiful new building with a bird's eye view of Kinnick Stadium. There you see in the top floor many of the patients, their families, gathering to watch this game, and a great new tradition. At the end of the first quarter, the entire stadium turns toward them and waves to show support. Share their strength, and we'll show that to you. Penn State takes over after a short punt in plus territory. Saquon Barkley had 6 touches in the first drive, but only 29 total yards. They fake it to him, and the ball is batted down. They tried to get it to Gesicki over the middle, but Josie Jewell was there with a hand.
Great job by Jewell timing that up and knocking it down, because Gesicki was open behind and over top of him, which is, you know, you look at McSorley, they list him at 6 feet. Got to get the ball up and over. It's not as if Jewell is that much taller, but he does do a good job. If not, that's a completion for at least 15 yards.
McSorley's first incompletion is 4 of 5. from the pocket on second down. Steps up, a downfield shot. And he throws it over the head of Saeed Blacknall, the senior, well covered by Manny Magumba. It's third and 10.
That might be one where they come back and revisit that. Joe Moorhead may have started to get a little bit of a feel for how Phil Parker, the defensive coordinator from Iowa, is trying to defend him. And even though he went downfield to the middle of the field to try to hit Blacknall, Gesicki actually on a route to the outside broke free. Nobody covered him. I'm sure that's something they'll revisit.
14 point per game increase last year in Moorhead's first year calling plays. Barkley made a catch and converted the last third and long. Again, the play clock is winding down. Does McSorley see it? And they have to call a timeout. Trying to make lots of adjustments up there, Kirk, but again, not enough time.
And he's frustrated. James Franklin frustrated because he wonders if he's getting the quarterbacks having enough time to be able to evaluate the defense and get the call from the sideline to be able to do what he needs to do at the line of scrimmage with getting the calls in. That's part of the adversity. You deal with it. They talked about crowd noise all week in State College, the practices that they had. But you get out here, and as much as you try to simulate it, you were out at practices.
Trust me, it was plenty loud.
Yeah, but it's still different. You know, that play clock's running, and it's just hard to simulate what you deal with. That's why Iowa has a history of being able to pull up upsets. This crowd is that 12th man. And they're a big factor in those upsets.
Franklin believes in preparing for nights like this, not just in 1 week, but throughout camp. They pump crowd noise in pretty consistently, but you're right. Hard to simulate 70,000. They make a lot of noise when I was on defense. They're almost silent when the Hawkeyes have the football.
You know, Chris Godwin was that go-to guy in these situations last year. They feel Jawan Johnson, 84, could be that guy this year.
McSorley feeling pressure. Swarmed and sacked for a second time. Anthony Nelson again got in there. And the Lions, despite great field position, will have to punt again.
That's coverage. That is a great job. They rush four. They have seven in coverage. And watch the pocket just collapse on top of the quarterback. It's just a push. See him at the bottom there. Anthony Nelson again. He gets eventually to him. But to me, McSorley's waiting and waiting for the play to develop and receivers to break free. But with seven guys playing zone and sitting back, just nowhere to go with the ball. So give coverage the credit for the sack for Nelson.
Here's Gilligan again. It's a huge win for the Iowa defense despite great field position. Penn State comes up entry, but the Hawkeyes are pinned back again at the 11. Maria Taylor, a great vantage point just across the way, spending the first quarter with some special people. Maria?
You're right, Chris. It's the best press box I've ever been to because it's the press box at the top of the Stead Family Children's Hospital. And I'm here with Caden Kelso. Now, you just had surgery on Monday, and you're battling cancer. But tell me the good news that you got from your doctors this week.
I'm just started being done with cancer. I beat it.
Congratulations, Caden. That is so awesome. And now you get to be here and watch your Hawkeyes play. Who is your favorite player on the team right now?
Nick Easley.
And why is that?
Because he's just really nice, and he came to see me, so I just thought it would be really nice.
Yeah, we got a picture of it right here. Now, what does it mean for you? You know you're going to see the wave for the very first time. You're going to see all of these fans turn and look at you. What will it mean to see that happening?
It'll be really touching. It's really nice that all the Hawkeyes do that and everybody else waves back up here to the hospital.
Now, I know it's hard. You're fighting cancer and it's not easy. But what does it mean to be able to take some time away from it and come and just watch a football game? It's your favorite sport.
It's awesome. It's cool that my family comes to see me and we all get to watch a football game.
Now, I know you're really good friends with Chris Fowler. He said he wanted to be in the press box with you over here. But you have a message for him. What do you want to say to Chris?
Hey, Chris.
Hey, Caden, that's great news that he
cool
just shared. Hey, thanks, buddy. Appreciate that. You too.
Congratulations, Chris. You're pretty cool over here.
He's the cool one, and what wonderful news that he got. Easley is from Newton, Iowa, the same town that Caden is from, and great job by Nick visiting him and delivering some autographed hats and some gloves.
Cool that a lot of the Hawkeye players, and what an amazing thing. You and I saw this beautiful building being built last year when we were here for the Michigan game, and to be able to come back and see it, it's incredible.
See if Easley or one of these receivers can make a play. Vandenberg had a drop on first down, and so now it's third and long again. Lions rushing four. Stanley's flushed, not really a natural runner, and Jason Cabinda, the middle linebacker, leader of the defense, is there to knock him down, and it's fourth down again.
They're trying to get some pressure on him. One thing they're doing a very good job of here, first of all, is field position. Iowa's been backed up deep in their territory these first couple possessions, and what Penn State has done is they've gotten him into those obvious passing situations, and then they've Brent Fry right now, defense coordinator for Penn State, is doing a good job of mixing it up and trying to confuse young Nate Stanley as much as he can.
It's a defense that has two shutouts already. Yes, it was Akron and Georgia State, but they also lead the FBS in tackles for loss through three games. A bunch of takeaways, six interceptions. So it's been a big play defense. Obviously, their biggest challenge tonight, though. It was a much better kick from Rastetter. And Tompkins is driven all the way back, bobbles it, but does collect the fair catch. That's what they're looking for, help the field position.
That is huge. I mean, you get lost sometimes. You talk about offense and defense, but special teams and hidden yardage, and especially being pinned back your first two possessions inside your own 10, that could flip the field. That is a heck of a job there by the punter.
It's a 52-yard punt. That's a very tricky play for Tompkins, who almost muffed it. So Nittany Lions take over at the 33, their third possession. And Barkley has been contained so far by this Hawkeyes defense. He's got it, and he's got a crease, a nice little cut. This tremendous blend of strength and speed, which is, I mean, it's just rare in a human being. I don't care what sport you play.
It is, and he just seems to get stronger and stronger. And that play, that time, they just decided not to even block Nelson, and Barkley is as strong as anybody you're going to see play, let alone running back. 405-pound power clean. He's probably as strong as anybody in the country, and he's a running back.
You see the hands, too. He makes a fingertip catch in the flat. He also, by the way, ran a 4.33 40, and he's one of the top Nittany Lions in every category in their strength training.
That was a goal of his when he came in. You know, he was an undersized kid as a young teenager and had to really fall in love with weight training. I'm pretty sure it paid off for him. And you can look down the list there, pretty much every workout.
A 5'7 kid is a sophomore in high school, right? Almost gave up the sport because he wasn't big and strong enough.
Yep.
The transformation. Second and five. Barkley's got it again. And didn't look like much, but he powers forward for six and another first down.
That's the beauty for Joe Moorhead. You know, they've had the ball first couple possessions, and we've almost gotten spoiled watching this offense with him in charge, where you expect such big things from them every possession. And a little bit of a rut the first two, so what do? They go back to old reliable, establishing number 26. That opens up their play-action game and eventually opens up those big pass plays downfield when they start to run the ball like that with Barkley.
Andre Robinson, number six, spelling Barkley. A guy was his roommate. They came in same recruiting class together. McSorley delivers short pitch and catch to DeAndre Tompkins inside the 35.
Brought both the middle linebackers. Blitz picked up by Robinson, who you mentioned just came into the game.
Lions continue to be very efficient on first down. Have to be among the best offenses in the country. They often gain first downs on first down.
And in this system, that's a big part. When they're really humming, that's a big part of what they need to do. They're not an offense that's built because of the passing scheme for those third and long situations.
Robinson, very small crease and a short gain, but it should be enough again to move the sticks. Nathan Bajda made the tackle. And the Lions will try to crank tempo on a very warm evening. It'll be a tough one of defense if they can't get subs in and out.
Crowd reacting again to the spot. The crowd thought he was a little bit short and said they give him the first down.
Saquon Barkley in the slot to the right of the formation. A little motion back. They fake it to him. McSorley looks in that direction. And there's space out there. Stutter steps and makes more out of it than it looked like he was going to. As we check in with Cassidy Hubbard for the first time tonight. Cassidy. Mm, Did you pick the Wildcats then?
I did, yes, sir.
Yes, you did. Second and one. It's Barkley cutting it back. Saquon Barkley tackled inside the 10. Nice job by Amani Hooker, but it'll be first and goal.
The last play, you saw the quickness down the sideline. And again, they're picking on the defensive end, Nelson, making him make a decision. And when he, how about the acceleration? We're talking all this, you know, what he can do with his hands, catching the ball, how quick he is. He has it all. The acceleration. He makes up his mind and he hits the afterburners. Boom, he's gone. And 5, 6, 7 yards in the blink of an eye.
They're feeding the superstar 11 touches. And Penn State's first 20 plays. He's getting the breather now. Robinson's in there. He's got it. Andre Robinson hammered out at the 2-yard line by Hooker and Ragumba. But Penn State's running game imposing itself.
Robinson is the power of their four backs. And they are very fortunate to have guys like Robinson and Sanders and Allen. A nice look from the progressive pylon cam. But you have the depth there. Just to be able to give Barkley a play or two once in a while. So he doesn't have all the wear and tear is nice. And they don't miss much when he has to go out, too. They got good backs.
Saquon back in there on second and goal. Penn State's been very efficient in the red zone so far this young season. But Iowa swarms the backfield. McSorley fights back for just a 1-yard loss. Ben Neiman flashed in there.
You know, when you're reading, you're making a read, the ball has to get in. Let's go real slow here. Watch this. Watch how the ball is not quite in there. See, the ball needs to be in the belly of Barkley to be able to make a decision as a quarterback if you want to pull it or give it. That time, just not quite on the same page. He was reaching to try to find Barkley, but he couldn't get the ball in there, and that's why the defense came down on McSorley.
And Kirk, this is one of those plays, yes, it's early in the game, but could be massive.
Yes.
And they hold Penn State to a field goal attempt.
Again, in this area, he's always a threat because of his size.
McSorley rolling, trying to run it himself, reaches the ball, doesn't get in. Bo Bauer forced him out. It'll be fourth down inside the one. What do you do here, Coach?
They're going to kick a field goal, but, you know, on the road, it makes sense to take three. How about the effort by Bauer? Because in a foot race, 9's going to beat 41 10 out of 10 times, but he takes the proper angle and is able to keep him just short of getting to that progressive pylon cam.
Not quite long enough arms for the quarterback to reach that pylon. And so this is Tyler Davis, the senior kicker, very efficient and effective. It's a tricky angle from 19 yards. And Penn State able to march it, again, somewhat methodically. They go 66 yards in 11 plays. The second drive, they've chewed up more than 5 minutes, but again, Iowa, poor field position the entire quarter, has to feel good about being down only 3-0.
Absolutely. I mean, again, Iowa needs to be able to have a better starting field position. You wonder after this kickoff, they get a decent return. Maybe it opens up things for Brian Ferentz as a play caller. But he's been backed up inside his own 10. It makes it very, very tough. So Penn State's controlled things, but Iowa's defense deserves a lot of credit for keeping him in the game at this point.
And you mentioned Phil Parker's number one mission, avoid those explosive plays. They can live with the methodical drives. Penn State, one of the most explosive offenses so far, haven't been able to create those plays.
No, not yet. And I think being able to play in this environment, we keep talking about it, but Iowa's part of their game plan when they play at home is to just kind of body blow, work around the ring, smack around, get you in trouble, they're in trouble. All of a sudden they look up and it's the fourth quarter and it's a one possession game. That's their game. That's how they've been able to upset people time after time in here.
Yeah, we keep making the comparison to Michigan's loss in here a year ago. It was 10-0 Wolverines, but Iowa hung around, actually turned it around and won it 14-13, 14 the weird way.
Yep.
Touchdown, two field goals, and a safety. Davis with the boot. Ivory Kelly Martin, true freshman returner, is hit hard and knocked down short of the 20. Excellent coverage by the Lions, and Brandon Smith, the linebacker, smacked there.
Yeah.
Week 3, Monday Night Football. Dak Prescott, former Mississippi State Bulldog, and the Cowboys take it on Carson Palmer, Heisman Trophy winner, and the Cardinals at Glendale. Coverage beginning with Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's at 6 Eastern on ESPN. Also on the Watch ESPN app.
I'm sure Zeke's anxious to get back out on the field after the last game that they played. got a little criticism in that game.
Once again, Iowa, bad field position. Short of the 20. Can they get Akram Wadley going? They beat him on first down. He is cut down. Both these running backs from the New York area. Saquon born in the Bronx and Wadley from across the river in Newark, New Jersey.
They've got talented running backs, but the offensive line, it's still a little bit of a work in progress. Brian Ferentz talking to us this week about, you know, you anytime you move a player, Sean Welsh from right guard out to right tackle, you've got a young left tackle who's a freshman, Jackson. They're still kind of developing that continuity. And if you're Penn State, you're loaded up against that running game, daring Iowa to have to throw.
On second and 10, short drop and a throw that is broken up, looking for Vandenberg. And a nice job in coverage there by Christian Campbell, that long senior corner.
And also just great technique. Anytime you're a corner, you're on an island like this, one thing you want to do is try to stay in phase. And phase means you're with the receiver, and then when he looks for the ball, you're going to look up for the ball. You see how he looked? And then he's able to use that long left arm to knock the ball away. But being in phase, which means he's got him covered, when that receiver starts to put his hands up, you read that and react and turn and knock the ball out.
Well, the Hawkeyes so far, Kirk, third and nine, and now third and 10. Not their wheelhouse. And State showing some pressure. They pick it up. Stanley has time, delivers over the middle, a strike, and the first down of the night for Iowa. Fant, the tight end.
On two fronts. Number one, Iowa's offensive line picking up the blitzes. That is incredible. You got two backers coming here. They pick it up. Look at this. And now the tight end, Fant, using his body. He kind of wedges Allen away from it, and Stanley sticks in there tough on third down and makes a heck of a throw where just his tight end can make a play on the ball.
All right, we'll see the wave to the folks in the Children's Hospital when we come back after this message and a word from your local ABC station. 3-0 Penn State after one. Just a very poignant, powerful moment here at the end of the first quarter. Iowa faithful turning and showing love and support for the patients and their families right across the way in the Stead Iowa Children's Hospital. Christy Young from Atlantic, Iowa had a brilliant idea. And Levi Thompson operates a Facebook page, got momentum for this going. And you heard Caden Kelso tell Maria Taylor how much it means to those kids and their families.
That's awesome.
You spend your days, Kirk, in those rooms. It could be lonely, hooked up to tubes, fighting unimaginable battles. And in Iowa home games, you get a special salute.
Very, very cool.
We send our love and support, too. So after converting on third down for the first time, Hawkeyes begin the second quarter from their 31. This is Stanley from the pocket, throwing behind Vandenberg. So they've tried to target the senior receiver a number of times, haven't connected yet.
We were just talking at the break with the way this game has started. It's going to be important for Iowa to throw on early downs to be able to have some success doing that, to just kind of loosen up the Penn State defense. Then they can get back to their bread and butter, which is running the ball. But running the ball on first and 10 with the way Penn State is stacking the line of scrimmage is going to be tough until they have a little bit of success throwing.
You mentioned Brian Ferentz, Kirk's oldest son, calling the plays for the first time this year. He calls a pitch back to Wadley, but he is swarmed and dropped for a loss by Kabinda. Ferentz, a former offensive lineman here at Iowa, was at the Patriots and was the tight end coach, coaching Gronk and learning from guys like Bill O'Brien and Bill Belichick.
Yeah, incredible to think that when you work within that organization with the New England Patriots, it's not just the offensive coordinator or the quarterback coach or the receiver coach. It's everybody all the way down. If you're on there as a part of that staff, they take the time to teach you their system and their philosophies. And Brian has brought what he's learned from his dad growing up and playing for his dad, and also the time he's able to be around Bill O'Brien and Bill Belichick.
Another third and long, they need 12. Stanley is flushed and just has to throw it away. So it's been a little frustrating so far for Brian Ferentz on the offense. Sharif Miller again pressured the quarterback, and they'll have to punt.
Yeah, Sharif Miller having a pretty good night right now, getting after Stanley.
Inspired, isn't he? Wearing his buddy's number 19 tonight.
He sure is. Torrence Brown, who is out, he decides to wear 19 to honor him. Tough loss, considering the loss last year of Evan Schwann, Garrett Sickles. That's a position where they have some great young players, but it's the last thing they really needed was Torrence Brown to go down with an injury.
Miller, one of those pass rush guys who talked about learning from Garrett Sickles and Carl Nassib. They've had some good edge rushers at Penn State in recent years. The lefty, Rastetter, He's been busy already, and this is not one of his best efforts. For the second time, not what they're looking for from the punting game. Spotted out near the Penn State 40. Keep you posted on that one. The Spartans and the Wolverines in a couple of weeks.
Just getting pulled away. McCorn came in.
Did he?
Spate, yeah.
Penn State, average starting field position, about right where they are right now, their own 38-yard line. Here's a first down throw. McSorley long and over the head of Saeed Blacknall.
Tonight it's been all Saquon Barkley for this Penn State offense. And a big thing that they reiterated this week was just trying to get 26 out in space, whether it's the running game or when he's out catching the football. You can see, look, if they can throw him the ball and he can turn and there's not a lot of people around him, they feel pretty good about what he can do after the catch. This is a good example. Shakes him, gets down the sideline, and picks up more yards.
He's got the ball, stutter step, and drop at the 45 by Miles Taylor. It'll be third and five.
You know, McSorley right now, it's one thing to have a great player like Barkley. It's another thing to need to spread the wealth. Barkley has five receptions, and McSorley has completed seven passes. Tompkins and Sanders, another running back, so really one receiver up to this point, and Gesicki's not been involved in it at all.
No, neither has Tayshaun Hamilton.
Yeah.
Surely has time on third down over the middle, and now they do get Juwan Johnson, the receiver, involved. They want to have him get a big year to step into that role. We talked about Godwin moving on.
He's the guy that needs to do it. It starts, by the way, right here with a nice block by Barkley. What do you do with the ball? What do you do when the ball is not in your hands? You pick up a big block right there, and that's the man, Johnson. Joe Moorhead telling us he feels that he's close to getting ready to explode, really starting to come into his own. 6'4", 226 pounds, and can fly. He's got to become a go-to guy this year for McSorley.
Yeah, you're right. Good size, 4'5 speed. They get 13 yards on that completion. McSorley rolls out, flips it far side to one of the tight ends, Jonathan Holland, and a very good tackle right there by Ben Neiman. Short game.
Yeah, that's a triple option. He's going to either give it, pull it out, and keep it. This time he keeps it. Instead of running, he throws it out there to his tight end, but well defended by this Hawkeye defense. Kind of stretched that out, took away both the run for the back and the quarterback. And anytime you get into the hands of 18, that's a win compared to 9 or 26.
You know they've gone to school on those RPO plays that Penn State thrives on. On second and nine, Barkley again, dump down, look out. Saquon in space, and he scoots near the marker at the 32. They're going to spot him just short. Going to give him that much space. I think you got to keep feeding the superstar, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. They completely flooded that area. All the defensive backs went downfield to the receivers, and nobody picked Barkley up out of the backfield.
You need about the length of a football here. McSorley keeps it, and he will move the sticks inside the Iowa 30. McSorley, efficient game last year in the route over Iowa. Only 11 completions, but he threw for 240, couple touchdowns, also ran for a touchdown.
One of our keys tonight for him was being a complement to Saquon Barkley. 26 cannot do it by himself. McSorley in the run game, and that zone read game has got to be a factor to remind that defense that he can pull it down.
From the pocket, gave a look to Barkley, and now throws it inaccurately, and Saquon couldn't come up with that one. Boy, they seem like they can create a touch for him in space almost at will against this Iowa defense.
Iowa wants to just try to keep it. They're willing to give him those receptions, give him the football, but they want to rally to it. Their whole thing is about trying to get 11 hats running to the football. They just rather not see things go behind them. So if it's in front of them and they can rally to it, they feel that that's part of their plan and what they want to do.
So far, great job doing that. They flip it to Barkley in the flat. Takes a couple Hawkeyes to wrestle him down, Neiman included. It'll be third down.
I mean, that he's already has 14 touches. We're 11 minutes to go in
the
second quarter. Yeah, 14 touches, and I was keeping things in front of them. They wouldn't mind that trend continuing, where they can get four or five guys to hit him play after play after play.
Because he's so busy on first and second down, he's got to come out on third and five. Empty backfield. Robinson, the running back, is in the slot. Gesicki to the left of the formation. Again, trying to make those adjustments with the clock ticking down and the crowd roaring. Just gets it away. Pressure, batted down. So Iowa changed their look late, Kirk.
Yeah, just out of sync. Even though he got that playoff, they're out of sync on third down. They end up bringing the linebacker here, who once again is able to knock that football down. Man, he does this well. You know, he's either going to hit you or he's going to knock that ball down. He's done this so many times in his career for the Iowa Hawkeye defense. Offensive line not in rhythm. The ball snapped with less than a second left. Just out of sync there offensively for Penn State on third down.
So Tyler Davis, they don't have enough guys on the field for this field goal attempt. James Franklin going to have to spend another timeout. Players were waving over there saying, we need another dude out here. And then we'll spend a timeout again. And that expression says a lot about the way things have gone in the first half. They've got the lead, but not clicking the way they expect.
It's the casualties of playing on the road. Remember last year? Remember how this game went? I mean, this was an ambush. Iowa went over to State College, and they showed up kind of flat, and Penn State made them pay
for
that.
First possession they scored.
This is when Penn State started to really pick up momentum, not just against Iowa. It didn't matter who they played. They were a confident football team, and Iowa happened to be there that night and got dominated in every phase of the game. And I think Iowa was kind of distraught. That was the week before they came back home and knocked off Michigan.
30 net rushing yards for the Hawkeyes in that game. They only have four so far tonight. So Davis, who converted the 19-yarder earlier, tries now from 41. The former soccer player at Bradley, who transferred to Penn State. And the snap was a little low. Trouble with the hold, and it's wide left.
So let's get this straight. Penn State has 151 yards. Iowa has 17. And Penn State's only leading 3-0. If you're Iowa, you're pretty happy right now.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Wells Fargo, is brought to you by Pacific Life. Experience the power of Pacific. Coca-Cola Zero Sugar. Real Coca-Cola taste. Zero sugar. Zero calories. And AT&T.
It's a very strange first 20 minutes, Kirk. Iowa's one of the best teams in the country in terms of time of possession. Penn State's one of the worst. And check this out. In terms of plays run, 32-12. Look at the yards.
Incredible. And yet, the last number, most important number, Penn State 3, Iowa nothing.
This is actually the Hawkeyes' best field position of the game so far. They're 23. See if they can get Akram Wadley going. Once again, quick penetration, has to sidestep a tackler. And Manny Bowen drops him for a short game.
Now they are moving people up front. They are trying to deal with that running game by dealing with a slanting defensive line, moving linebackers, really trying to make this offensive line have to think. When you're a moving target for a line that's still trying to build continuity, makes it very tough on the communication up front.
And Wadley, who is a slashing runner with great vision and speed, has gained a total of 3 yards in his first 5 carries. He's got it again. Just nowhere to go. A swarming defense in Penn State. Stops him for no gain. It'll be third and long again.
I love Christian Campbell, a corner. Doesn't necessarily make the tackle, but keep an eye on him. He has a big role here because he's got to get to the outside and not let him bounce that. Force him back to the inside. And once he shows up to the outside to set the edge, look, you see Wiley put his right foot in the ground. It's because Campbell showed up immediately outside. He had nowhere to go. Boy, this defense is flying right now for Penn State.
And Curtis Cothran, one of the two 300-pounders anchoring the middle, along with Parker Cothran, no relation.
Yeah.
He got there as well. Hawkeyes need 7. Stanley has time, delivers. Incomplete again, a drop. That's the freshman Smith Marcet. There was a flag down in the secondary. And it's going to be against Iowa. Preliminary indication, a push-off against the Hawkeyes.
I think it may have been on Fant, where they were trying to run a mesh route, like a rub route, but instead it maybe came across as a pick to the official.
Pass interference. Offense number 87.
Yeah, that's who they got.
Penalties declined. Fourth down.
So Iowa will punt it away again. That's their third three and out in four possessions so far.
Big tight end. These are these rub routes. See where he cross guys. He just runs right into the linebacker, Bowen. And that official was deep in center field. Makes that call.
Penn State has twice come after the new punter. Rastetter struggled tonight. Again, not a very good boot. It'll take a nice Iowa roll, and Tompkins has to just get away from it. It almost touched him. There is a flag down near the line of scrimmage, so we'll check that first. New punter, and Penn State has decided we're going to pressure the young guy, come after him, and the results have been very spotty so far.
Illegal formation. On the offense, five players lined up in the backfield. 5 yards from the previous spot. Repeat fourth down.
Yeah, they'll make him repunt it. Tompkins had a touchdown on a punt return, 61 yards in the opener against Akron. So he is a dangerous guy. Rastetter being a lefty, though, it creates kind of a funky spin off of his foot. He's capable of rugby punting as well. Trying to do their best to limit dangerous returns. This has been an adventure. See if Penn State comes after this one again. They do. Gets it off, but again, not very good. And Tompkins had a chance. Bumped into, that's going to be a penalty on Iowa. Really couldn't get up to make the fair catch. So kick catch interference.
Think about, by having that illegal formation, where that first punt was to where this is going to end up. You're talking about maybe a 20 or 25-yard swing.
Kick catch interference. Kicking team number 26. 15 yards from the end of the kick. First down. Timeout.
So you take a 28-yard punt. That was it. Add 15 onto it. Two penalties in that punt sequence for Iowa. And Penn State, once again, will have tremendous field position.
Instead, are they going to win a game?
Wow.
Cassidy, come on. Are you kidding me?
Just hanging around.
What's going on in Waco?
So after back-to-back penalties in the punt, a difference of 34 yards in field position, Barkley. Hit hard. They don't give it to him. McSorley's dropped for a 2-yard loss, but flying in there was Epinesa, the freshman defensive end.
Who they think's going to be a superstar. How about the quickness coming off the edge here? Nobody blocks him. Good job by McSorley making that read, pulling that ball and holding on to it. I'm just glad to see Barkley get up from that hit.
He's thinking, I had 14 touches. Now I get catapulted on a play and I don't even get the ball? Miles Sanders spelling him. Second and 12. McSorley to a wide open receiver, but an underthrow. Wow, Gesicki leaked out there. Jackson wasn't near him, and not the throw that Trace was looking for.
Well, I think Gesicki is looking to go out and up on a wheel route, and McSorley's kind of running out of time, thinking, hey, I'm going to throw it to him out in the flat, and he just ends up throwing it out there. But again, it's just very unusual to see a Penn State offense with Joe Moorhead and the way they played these last 13 games just not quite clicking right now.
I think you're right. McSorley out of sorts. Sanders is the back on third and 12. And there's another incompletion. Felt a little pressure, delivered it poorly, and Penn State once again given tremendous field position by the penalties, goes three and out.
Yeah, I couldn't tell. Did Brady Reef, 91, get his hand on it? He kind of spins to the outside. I couldn't tell if he ends up getting his hand up and maybe knocking that ball down, or at least maybe getting a finger on it. But
good,
yeah,
spot.
Yeah, it looks like he did. But McSorley unable again to find his intended target. And how about this Iowa defense?
Well, they've now batted down three McSorley passes. You can't ask more of a defensive unit. They have been backed up the entire half. Gilligan, Tries to pin him deep one more time. Good job spinning it. And the coverage scene, you cannot execute it better than that. Irvin Charles, a receiver, standing at the one waiting for it.
Great play by Charles, but just what Brian Ferentz needed.
Exactly.
Come on out, coach. First and 10 on your own one.
You should be used to it by now. Time for the Bear Kirk. He was back near his old stomping grounds in Times Square this morning.
He was.
Joined us for our annual trivia, or our weekly trivia test.
Good evening, Bear.
I know you were mad at me last week. I gave you a hard question. So now, for tonight's Aflac trivia question, I'm going to put it a little bit more in your wheelhouse.
Okay.
Big Ten style.
All right.
Last year, Saquon had 167 against Iowa. Who holds the Penn State rushing record in a game against Iowa?
Think about that as the Hawkeyes take over, pin back at their
one.
Come on,
Larry Johnson on you, just dropping that mic.
It was just sneaky with Stanley to get a couple of precious yards.
I'm just going to drop the hammer on you right there. Larry Johnson, what do you think?
Good guess, but you are incorrect.
Oh, man.
We going back to like John Cappelletti or Franco Harris?
Kajana Carter up in here?
Maybe we're going to predate all of those guys, actually. The answer to tonight's Aflac trivia question, we got to go back 1971. Lydell Mitchell, 211 yards.
Not Franco Harris, but his backfield mate early 70s.
Baltimore Colts, right?
Yeah. The Hawkeyes, a total of 9 rushing yards now. Wadley from his end zone, sprinting to just avoid his safety, and he cannot. The Lions trap him, and it's Sharif Miller playing an inspired first half, wearing his buddy's number, and Penn State's defense gets on the board.
Boy, these two defenses are playing out of their minds. And Penn State, they've been backing up this Iowa offense, backing up the Iowa offense, and now this time they're able to just get to the outside. That is tremendous speed by Miller, who's wearing that number 19. You can see Allen comes in to clean it up. They do not respect the Hawkeyes' ability right now to throw, and they are attacking the line of scrimmage and attacking the running game. Makes it so hard on Wadley in this offensive line.
I mean, Miller is a high motor guy, a very motivated player, but he's playing with inspiration. You know, Torrence Brown back watching this game, having that serious knee injury, watching his buddy show up wearing his number tonight, and Penn State, a 5-0 lead. It's kind of an Iowa-type score.
It is.
They're on the short end, but,
right.
Penn State has run 22 plays in plus territory. The offense has come up with 3, and now they figure after the free kick to get pretty good field position again.
Yeah, it's just, remember we went to the break, we talked about Charles, and Charles downing that ball at the 1-yard line, and Brian Ferentz, as if he hadn't had a tough enough night trying to call plays, being backed up near his own end zone. Now he's at his own one. They're just trying to get out of there and punt the ball.
They've had 3 punts down from the 10 in. And obviously, field position producing that 2 points. And now Barkley is back at his own 15. It's going to be a kickoff from Recinos. And they will kick it right to Barkley. So Saquon backs up to the 11. Spins and is knocked down at the 35. Well, we salute teachers this week, part of the College Football Playoff Foundation's Extra Yards for Teachers program. An influential teacher in Saquon's life was Alicia Knopf, who was assistant principal at Whitehall Prep and Whitehall Township, PA.
I just can't say how incredibly proud I am of him and how he hasn't forgotten about the people who have helped him along the course of the way. When he went away to college, I said to him, do what's right when no one's watching and the rest will follow. And I feel like he's really done that.
He sure has.
Very cool.
McSorley on the keeper, cuts it back, knocked down after an 8-yard gain.
Probably the greatest thing you can say when you talk about Barkley is his humility.
Yes.
With all the accolades, he's one of the hardest working guys you're ever going to meet. One of the quietest guys. He wants to compliment everybody else besides himself. I mean, he is everything that is right about the sport.
He's actually pretty shy with all the attention.
Yeah.
Doesn't consider himself a superstar. I got news for him. There's a completion across the middle as Juwan Johnson makes his second catch and goes inside the Iowa 40.
Yeah, not only are the linebackers going to start to sneak up, but even the safety Hooker starts to come up. Because, again, the run threat of Barkley. Now you see him up here. Now that makes it very, very easy for McSorley to make that throw to the big Juwan Johnson at 6'4".
They get 18 yards. They work the middle well, as they typically do.
That's the Penn State offense. Run the ball, run the ball. Get the safety out of position. Make him pay for it with the slant behind him.
Once again in Hawkeyes territory. The 23rd snap. And McSorley again for the fourth time as a ball batted down to the line of scrimmage. And it's Anthony Nelson has been a monster so far.
6'7". We've seen Josie Jewell knock down a couple. This time the big fella, 6'7", 260. He blocked out with his elbow.
Yeah.
he didn't have to get up there. 6'7". He's had a big night tonight.
He's one of 10 legacy players whose dad's played at Iowa. His dad, Jeff, played in the early 90s here. Big family tradition in this program. It's a pitch to Barkley. Can he get the edge? Outruns Jewell and scampers for about 7.
That's what speed does for you. All that lifting, all that training. Josie Jewell's a veteran, instinctive player, but he cannot get to the corner before Barkley's able to get around it. Set up third and short, much more manageable.
Lions are just 3 of 8, but haven't had too many like this, third and short. Hawkeye crowd on his feet. And the whistle is 4. And Iowa will spend the timeout on defense.
Charge timeout, Iowa.
Phil Parker is spotting something, Kirk. Boy, you know, you just have the feeling that Iowa's defense being asked again and again and again to come up with big stops on a hot night. They've been on the field a lot, and that's not something they're used to doing. They're used to having the football themselves a lot.
But the field position could not be any worse for Iowa, and so it's a combination of everything. Look at these numbers. I mean, this is Kirk Ferentz's worst nightmare, to think that it's only 5-0 and to think that Penn State's offense has only managed 3. When you look at these numbers, it's mind-boggling, and you got to give Iowa's defense all the credit with Phil Parker and the way they've been able to keep Saquon Barkley. It's not just any offense. It's this Penn State offense. It scores on everybody, usually putting 40 or 50 points up. So we'll see how long they can withstand this pressure.
It's the mental stress of defending
absolutely.
This offense.
Yeah. It's not to mention when they're taking every snap inside your 30-yard line.
The Hawkeyes defense talks about it. Nittany Lions up to the line needing 3. Play clock at 3. McSorley backpedals and delivers a looping throw down the middle, and it is incomplete. Well defended. Brandon Polk was the intended receiver. Amani Hooker broke it up, and it's fourth down.
What a play by Amani Hooker. He's taken over that starting spot at free safety for Jake Gervas. Goes up into the air. You talk about high pointing the ball. Watch Hooker go up. Almost comes down with the interception.
They're going to go for it on 4th and 3. Very much fringe field goal range for Davis, who's missed one earlier. They fake it to Barkley. McSorley backpedals, delivers, incomplete. A diving attempt again by Brandon Polk, but pressure got to McSorley, and Iowa's defense holds again.
What a great job. You see, Gesicki's going to go in motion, work to the flat, and watch the linebacker, Bo Bauer, take him away. He deals with the play-action fake, takes Gesicki out, makes it much, much harder on McSorley to make that throw. You could make an argument that Polk could come up with that. It's low and away, but it was a tough throw, and they really wanted to try to get the ball out to their tight end, but Bauer takes it away.
Those were high school teammates trying to hook up at Briarwoods High School. Ashburn, Virginia. Polk, who missed almost all of last year with an injury. Very, very catchable ball there to keep the drive alive. Instead, Iowa takes over. They're 32, which constitutes great field position tonight. And Wadley in space. Cannot escape the tackle of Troy Apke. Maria?
Guys, I know you discussed it a little bit, but the uniqueness of the fans being so close to every huddle. I've seen the defense struggling to just hear their defensive line coach, Sean Spencer, talk to them. The huddles have gotten closer and closer together. The fans are relentless and standing the entire time, even during timeouts, making it difficult for them to get instructions from their coaches on the sideline.
Yeah, one Penn State fan, Maria, right there in the front row.
Looks like you're security.
Right. I mean, you know, you gotta watch. You gotta watch your helmet, Kirk. You ever play here?
Oh yeah.
You leave your helmet on the bench. It's been known to go missing. The fans will grab it and take it up in the stands.
No doubt. I mean, that's part of the intimidation of playing here. And, you know, right here, he's, I think 14's in charge. We're in Tom Blackledge's jersey. I think he's in charge of security up there. But they get on top of you, and they let you know, especially in the heat, when things get really, really going in the heat of a battle.
They actually moved that front row back a few feet. They carved out some space, but it's still about as tight as anywhere in college football.
Oh, for sure.
The Hawkeyes once again face a third down, needing four. Easily comes in motion. Stanley from the pocket delivers over the middle. Catch made, but right at the marker is Easley. And Caden Kelso up there in the hospital will be very pleased. His favorite player has made a catch, and almost a sarcastic cheer from the Iowa crowd here.
Second first down of the game, and that's the reaction you get. But what started that sequence of plays? A little play-action pass, throw out into the flat by Wadley. They're going to have to continue to mix that look in just to give Penn State, try to spread the Penn State defense out instead of playing them kind of in a phone booth where they're very, very tough.
Hawkeyes up to 31 total yards now with that pass play. Wadley has not gotten anything going on the ground at all. The middle is clogged. Cassidy. Cassidy, thank you. Wadley, got to be frustrated, Kirk, by the way this game has started. Nine rushes, net 2 yards for the dangerous tailback. He's got it again, and they are swarming him again. Sharif Miller and Marcus Allen, and there are some boos for this offensive line.
Well, at the risk of sounding repetitive, when you do not fear the pass game, you just fire into this line of scrimmage. You're going to go after the running game. You get low, you just get after the all. I don't care what offensive line you have. When a defense is just attacking the line of scrimmage and they don't respect anything on the perimeter, that's what the result's going to be.
It's a veteran group, that offensive line. Two seniors, two juniors, and a freshman. They take great pride in that unit. They have been overwhelmed so far tonight. Stanley has pretty good protection, puts it very short. And not much there. And once again, it's going to be time to punt. Wadley, just no room as a runner or a receiver.
Again, I think as Iowa continues to get better field position, I think you're going to see more of a willingness to take a few more chances on early downs and try to spread the Penn State defense out. As I said, it is going to be tough. As good as their line is and as physical as they are, they're still trying to build continuity up front. And you're going to have to throw to set up the run, in my opinion, tonight.
You know, Penn State's defense at times was on its heels against Pittsburgh. Panthers had a couple of long drives. We didn't learn a whole lot. I mean, they did shut out Akron and Georgia State. The shutout's a shutout in college football. But I think tonight they've taken it to another level on the road, just swarming the line of scrimmage. 23 plays for 33 yards.
And you know, we've talked a lot about
5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Trying to kill some clock. We've talked a lot about Joe Moorhead, but Brent Fry, the defensive coordinator from Penn State, he took over for Bob Shoup, who went to Tennessee last year, did a very, very good job a year ago, continued the effort with the recruiting and the athletes that they have, and continuing to understand what he wants to do. They're playing so fast tonight, and they played that way really from the second half of last year all the way up to tonight.
It's the rugby punt. For the first time tonight, and it's very effective. And for a change, it'll be the Nittany Lions will be backed up deep. Minute 52 before halftime and a 5-0 lead. Kickoff week 2 of your NFL Sunday with Countdown at 10 a.m. over on ESPN. Gang joining new host Sam Ponder. The news right up to kickoff. Sunday, 10 a.m. also on the ESPN app. So if you're James Franklin and his play caller, Joe Moorhead, you figure, Kirk, with the lead here, you don't want to make a mistake on offense and give Iowa a chance to claim the lead before halftime. And a half that you've completely dominated.
No, you got a minute 52. Iowa has a couple timeouts left, so probably going to be somewhat conservative here.
Barkley Nowhere to run with the sidestep, quick penetration. He'll lose yardage. Sam Brinks cleaned it up.
What a great effort by this defensive line. Brinks, who's in there for Anthony Nelson this time. You know, you lose Nelson, who's 6'7", 260, and here comes Brinks at 6'5", 275. A physical defensive line from the Hawkeyes this year.
Ferentz saves his timeout. Second and 12. McSorley from the end zone has time and delivers into a nice crease, and the catch is made there by Deshaun Hamilton for the first time tonight. He gets involved.
Gives you an idea of the arm strength that McSorley has. That is a throw that has to be thrown over top of the outside linebacker, Neiman, and he does a great job of waiting for it to develop, throws it right over top of the linebacker, right into the hands, and now they're thinking maybe about getting a little bit more aggressive.
171st career reception for Hamilton is going to be the all-time receiver within the next few games. And it's a long throw, and DeAndre Tompkins is driven out at the 34.
And gets out of bounds, and all of a sudden there's a little bit of life in McSorley. You know, McSorley is kind of a, to me, when I've watched him, when he's really going, he's got some energy to him. He's got a little bit of an attitude. Tonight he's been a little bit quieter. These last couple passes, I've seen a little bit of a jog to him, a little bit more of an anxiousness about him and energy about him.
Barkley, a busy first half, breaks free and is knocked down. Another first down to the 45. Hooker made the tackle, and the Lions will play fast now.
Yeah, about a minute still. Clock stops, obviously, in a college game with the first down. Still going to try to just hold on to that last timeout.
Inside of a minute. McSorley doesn't see the pressure, is hit as he throws, and it's intercepted. Josie Jewell has blockers. Barkley will finally wrestle him down, but Iowa with the takeaway. And with 43 seconds before halftime, they are set up.
How about the effort, Chris, by the backup, Sam Brinks, who gets to McSorley as he's trying to throw the football. He's out here getting the pressure. Here's Josie, who's just going to read the quarterback's eyes. But I think Brinks from behind, as McSorley steps up right there, affects that throw. And that's what makes it easy for Jewell to just be able to come up with that interception. He's closing in, hits him right as he's throwing the ball to Gesicki over behind him, over the top. The ball is thrown errant, and there's Jewell, the big senior leader, with the interception.
Second interception McSorley has thrown. You're exactly right. Credit the pass rush again. Could Iowa actually claim the lead? Stanley from the pocket, hit as he throws. Goes for the end zone. Touchdown, Easley. Nick Easley, the junior from Newton, Iowa. And suddenly, shockingly, Iowa has the lead. Four total yards of offense, but the takeaway creates the opportunity, and that's Stanley's best throw tonight.
How does Iowa upset so many top five teams here in Kinnick? This first half is exactly how they do it. They just kind of hang around and then end up coming up with a turnover and then a touchdown. Watch how Stanley freezes the safety, Allen, with his eyes. Watch his head, and watch how he keeps him in the middle of the field. See how he's looking right to keep him here? Now he's got a one-on-one matchup, and he's going to throw it behind the one-on-one matchup with the safety right over top of Troy Apke. But it was a great job of freezing the middle field safety and then throwing the mismatch here. Receiver against safety, his top receiver against a strong safety. That's a matchup that he feels that Easley can make every single time, and a heck of a throw by Stanley, who hadn't had many opportunities tonight to make those throws.
An offense that had been totally dormant until that moment finally runs its first play in Penn State territory. That's a 21-yard touchdown. And Caden Kelso up there, we visited with him early. He's got to be stoked.
I'm thinking of Caden up there. Caden's looking down watching this game. That's his man, his favorite player, just scored a touchdown.
You said it, the formula for an upset. We've seen it time and time again. Hang around,
body
wait
blow
for your chance.
Take a shot. Boy, I can't say enough about Phil Parker and the Hawkeye defense. I mean, it's incredible first half by the Hawkeye defense.
It's Barkley from the goal line. And he is tripped up. And with just 32 seconds to go, you figure the Lions will be pleased to just go in the locker room and regroup. The BMW halftime report. Kevin Agandi, Matt Brown, and Booger McFarland is coming up. Update you on what's going on around the country. Busy night, but perhaps another patented Iowa upset of a top five visitor brewing here. And as Penn State, dominant, creating great field position with special teams. Defense playing extremely well for the most part, but give up the touchdown pass and find themselves behind, and Kinnick has come to life. There was some sarcastic cheers and a few boos for their Hawkeyes in the first half. Now they're roaring.
Sarcastic cheer after their second first down.
Yes.
Now they got the crowd. That two plays, an interception by Jewell, the next play, the touchdown by Easley, and it's a different atmosphere. And the Hawks get the ball to start the second half.
They do. He's here with Maria Taylor.
All right, Coach, a turnover changes the complexion of the first half. What did you see on the interception by McSorley?
Well, we got pressure off the backside. Our right tackle got beat. Mike Kosicki was wide open on a corner route, but we weren't able to get it to him.
All right, how do you build a rhythm on this offense coming out of that halftime locker room?
Well, our defense is playing great. We've had great field position all day long. We got to take advantage of it. Luckily, we can fall back on last year, second half team.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, there was the trademark last year. They've been a very fast-starting team so far this season. But Iowa, 7-5. What else would it be here in Iowa City? BMW Halftime Report right after these messages. That's certainly Penn State's unspoken goal to reach that playoff, but perhaps another upset trap in Iowa City for a top-five team. Ready for the second half on Saturday Night Football, presented by Wells Fargo, and this presentation of the Big Ten on ABC. So in the first half, the Nittany Lions run about double the number of offensive plays. They gain four times as many yards as Iowa, but that late interception sets up the touchdown pass, and the Hawkeyes will get the ball here up two.
Yeah, that's about as wacky a first half as you could ever think of seeing. But
is it wacky?
We're in Iowa City.
Exactly.
I mean, it's 7-5 at halftime, and Penn State had I don't know how many snaps in Iowa territory and only came away with 3 points offensively. Of course, the safety to get them to five. But this is James Franklin made a comment to Maria walking off. We're a second-half team. We're going to make adjustments. We're going to find ways to finish these drives and score points. And, of course, I was thinking more of the same for that Hawkeye defense and what they were able to do.
Saquon Barkley was very busy, Kirk. 17 touches in the first half, but barely 100 all-purpose yards. So the Lions to kick it away. And Davis drives Kelly Martin into the end zone. He will take a knee. Our Pacific Life game summary, you're going to feature what else? Defense. You know, Sharif Miller flying in there, trapping Wadley for a safety. That made it 5-0. But then, can we call him the Jewel Thief? Josie Jewel with the pick here?
Yeah, definitely the interception, thanks to the pass rush by Sam Brinks. Sets up the very next play. Stanley downfield to Nick Easley, who goes up in one-on-one coverage against Troy Apke for the touchdown and gives the Hawkeyes some momentum going in at half and also the lead at 7-5.
Stanley, a tough first half until that moment. He had just 27 passing yards before the touchdown. And Akram Wadley, their main weapon, he has really been contained by this Penn State defense.
Talked about the importance of him throwing the ball a little bit.
They barely get it snapped, and Wadley is trapped, and it's that man Sharif Miller again in the backfield.
Yeah, there's some confusion. Lucky to get the ball snapped here. He just comes right around with the speed. Nobody even tries to block him. Like the tight end, T.J. Hawkinson, maybe a little confused with the play calling, came down instead of going out.
Four more tackles for loss for this defense. It's among the best in the country in that department. And Iowa, again, behind the sticks on second down. Stanley flips it. Once again, they are all over Wadley. He escapes Kabinda initially, but then the linebacker knocks him down. Third and long again. Maria?
checked in with Coach Ferentz, and he basically told me that you've got to be kidding with the 55 yards or 54 yards of total offense. But he also said they're leading this game because their team is playing every single snap, and they haven't given up. And earlier this week, speaking with Josie Jewell, the senior linebacker, he said one thing this team always believes when they're playing at home is that they're never out of a matchup, and it doesn't matter what the ranking is, and that's something they're going to battle through, and execution will ultimately be the difference in this game.
Now, you're right. They love the underdog role. This Penn State defense has come out with a purpose at the beginning of the third quarter. Back-to-back three-yard losses. And it's third and 16. Once again, they get in and swarm the quarterback. He gets it away to Kelly Martin, but the pursuit is there, and Christian Campbell makes the tackle, and it's three and out.
And Kevin Gibbons, who I think has got a bright, bright future. Watch him just work there. Boy, he has such quickness. You know, you think of Miller on the outside. You think of some of the guys that they can bring with pressure, with blitzes. But when Kevin Gibbons, 30, comes in as a sophomore, he gives him that presence to be able to get after the quarterback and force Stanley to just get rid of the ball. He's fortunate to even complete it.
You're exactly right. Almost 300 pounds. Very quick. Big future there. Rastetter, the lefty, gets it away. Tompkins this time, no fair catch. Spins free. A short return to the 42. Noah Clayburgh on the tackle, and Tompkins is down. So we'll be check his injury. What do you tell Trace McSorley? You said near the end of the half, Kirk, he was finally getting some mojo, but then the ball tipped, Jewel with the pick.
I trust him. I've seen too many examples of him being able to execute, so I trust him to do what he's going to do and continue to execute the offense, and came in with a plan. You got to go out and make a few tweaks to it, but got to put the ball in the end zone, and I think they trust nine to be able to do that.
Moment of prayer for his teammate Tompkins, who's still being looked at right by the Penn State bench after that punt return. McSorley is a quarterback that's thrown a touchdown pass in 18 consecutive games, and that streak of 10 straight 30-plus points, very much in jeopardy. Tompkins, good news, up, appears to be okay. DeAndre Tompkins up, jumping around after a brief conversation with the athletic trainer about that knee. Appears to be okay as the Lions go back to work. First possession after halftime from their 42. Sorley attempting 25 passes in the first half, including 14 of them. Still got it. Rolling out. No Hawkeyes in the neighborhood, and he'll take that every time. He picks up about 17.
You say, what do? The one thing you want to do is probably avoid Josie Jewell, who had a big first half, and really, I think, the backbone and the glue of the Hawkeyes defense all year, the captain who's played so much football. His instincts, ability to make plays, doing everything he can to slow down this offense, and of course came up with the big interception to lead them to their next play, the touchdown for the Hawks.
Barkley, the first in the clear. Saquon Barkley's got the corner. Saquon Barkley run out inside the 10. That's his most explosive play tonight.
That kind of is Saquon Barkley on one play. The vision, the quickness, the power. Watch him run through two tacklers. Right through and with the power, the leg drive, and then the suddenness and quickness to tiptoe down the sidelines and almost takes it into the end zone.
Yeah, he stepped out maybe before where they're marking this. They need to stop and take a look at the spot.
The previous play is under further review.
But you're exactly right. You know, Barkley, in talking to Phil Parker, where do you tackle him? You can't try to tackle him in those thighs. He's very powerful in the upper body. Yeah. He was trying to tell his guys to dive low, try to, you know, go for the ankles and the shins. That attempt there, but yeah, you can see he stepped out.
He stepped out, but it looked like even two steps before that, it was really close.
Crowd has spotted it on the monitor here. This will not be first and goal until they correct that spot.
Right when Rugumba 5 hits him, his right foot goes down, and it right here, right when he hits him initially, right there, looks like he does a good job of staying in bounds.
Hey, Kirk, we got to feed one of our playmakers.
Yeah,
Dave Kataya, our rule expert. We haven't gotten him the ball once tonight. Dave, this seems pretty clear cut, but tell me how an official misses that when it's sort of right in front of him.
Well, he's looking. There's two officials bracketing in between. Okay, one of them's got to see that foot down. It seems obvious, but they're not going to take a chance. Because if they blow the whistle, replay's out of this.
Yeah.
Okay? So they're not going to take a
chance. I like that.
Yeah.
I mean, absolutely.
Yeah.
Turn them loose, and then we can go back and look at it.
Because if you blow the whistle, you can't turn around and make it a touchdown.
Yeah.
Fowler, that's
Fowler's
very,
going
very
after
well
the officials,
said.
And Dave, you know,
well,
we got to take care of them.
White stripe, black shoe. It was very clear cut.
I think he's at about the 18. What do you got?
You can see the helmet of Saquon. That some of the Cyclones, there's been some collisions on number 26 so far tonight.
Been after him.
Nothing illegal, but he has been hit hard.
So what happens? What is he up to? How many touches does he have? 18?
Yep, 18. 146 all-purpose yards. Yeah,
kicks
off. He's never cramped. You see a guy with that much muscle mass. I told him how hot it's going to be. He says, well, I don't want to think about it, but I've never been a cramper. And he's built and trained for this kind of a workload.
Pays off on nights like this, and usually he gets better as the game goes on. One of those, never forget that Rose Bowl against USC.
Wow.
You know, that second half, he just took the game over.
And so Sam Darnold came back and took it over.
Yeah,
he
took it back. He took it back. Offensively, he took it over.
So the initial spot was the 7. Let's see where they put this ball.
After further review, the runner stepped out of bounds at the 18-yard line. It'll be 1st and 10 at that spot. Please adjust the game clock to 12 minutes, 38 seconds.
So Penn State in the red zone, thinking 7, not 3.
Meanwhile, you can already see Penn State over the ball and ready. It gives you an idea of one of their adjustments. Let's get the tempo going. Let's try to be the aggressor. Get the Hawkeyes more on their heels defensively.
And the review certainly gave the defense a nice rest. And Barkley scoots free again. Saquon gets the edge and dives close. He'll be just short of the goal line.
Maybe we talked about the matchup with Barkley and Jewell. How about this jump cut right here? Jewell is right here, has him, looks like he has a chance to make a play. Untouched. Oh, the jump cut.
No.
Another jump cut to the outside. And then the speed to almost get it to the end zone.
Stepped out just before the dive, so 1st and goal at the 2. empty backfield. Now they'll motion Saquon back in. Barkley stopped at the one. Jewel again. That's how won the battle.
Good job up front by that Iowa defensive line, getting low, eating up those blocks and freeing up Jewel and the linebackers to try to get in there. Tough to stop Barkley down in this area.
Once again, motions back. Keeper, and McSorley dragged down by Jewel for a loss. Back to the three. Very aware of quarterback runs tonight.
And they were ready for that. Great job of staying home and getting to the outside. Not going after Barkley. Great instincts, great vision on the football, and takes away that outside potential threat by McSorley.
And Gesicki, who's a great pass catcher, but not an accomplished blocking tight end. He got knocked down and messed up the timing. Third and goal.
Can the Hawkeyes defense do it again?
McSorley, end zone, jump ball. Incomplete. They tried to get it to Johnson, and Josh Jackson broke it up. Fourth down. Field goal coming.
Well, these defensive backs from Iowa are so well schooled. Watch the eyes of 15. As soon as the receiver looks, he's got his eyes and his head turned and looking for that football to be able to get up in the air and knock that away. Remember, Juwan Johnson is 6'4". That's why the ball was thrown up so high, to try to high point it. But Josh Jackson up as well with some height and knocks that ball away.
Tyler Davis, one of two. This is his second chip shot of the night from 21. And the lead. And Penn State still unable to find the end zone, but does reclaim the lead. 8-7.
And the Norris.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Wells Fargo, is brought to you by AT&T. Goodyear, hardworking tires that deliver blimp-worthy performance. And Ford, going further so you can.
Now, despite a running back who will join the long list of Penn State greats, the Lions have had drives stall at the Iowa 1, and now the Iowa 3. They had first and goal at the 2 and still unable to punch it in.
An incredible effort tonight by this Iowa defense. Not only keeping them in this football game, but giving them a chance to be able to win this football game. You knew it was going to take that effort, along with the 12th man of this crowd, to give them a chance against a high-powered offense like Trace McSorley and Saquon Barkley. And so far, they've delivered.
Kelly Martin is the returner at the 4. And the freshman knocked down across the 20. The Lions defense deserves a ton of credit, too.
A lot of it has to do with where the ball has been. But a 1st and 10 has been tough tonight for Iowa. And it's because those white jerseys are flying downhill. They don't respect the pass game on early downs. So they're really coming after the line of scrimmage. Now, this is a 1st and 10 at the end of the half where they got some momentum, had better field position, and they took a shot. Again, if they're going to be able to move the ball, they're going to have to try to mix up the looks and mix in some play calling where you have some play action passes on early downs.
And they've done that. Brian Ferentz was a short throw in the 1st down, and they involved Vandenberg. They've taken plenty of downfield shots, but Stanley, who's got a big arm, has overthrown them at a pretty alarming rate so far this year.
Yeah, he has this year, but I'm saying tonight against this defense where they're facing a very, very athletic, aggressive defense. Clearly, this Penn State defense with Brent Pry, they came in thinking, hey, until you can throw it by us, we're going to try to take away your running game, and makes it very tough on those early downs to run when you're dealing with that kind of an aggressive approach from a defense.
We'll see when they finally take their first downfield shot. As Wadley, that's his best run of the night, and it's a 1st down across the 37.
And sometimes when even you just throw the quick game, that was a quick little pass for 5 yards, at least lets him know you're going to do something else besides run the ball. And in defense of Brian Ferentz, he's been backed up inside his 10-yard line almost the whole night on a lot of his 1st and 10s. They're just trying to get out of, you know, deep in their own territory, so they've been somewhat conservative. Now they have a little bit of breathing room, and it opens up the playbook a little bit more.
Wadley, a guy who tweaked an ankle, didn't play in the 2nd half last week, but by all accounts is at 100% or close to it. He's got it again, but he's got nowhere to run. Drop for a loss. Manny Bowen, the linebacker, on the edge. They'll lose two.
And this is kind of what I'm talking about on first and 10. Watch the linebackers. Watch how quickly they flow. And tell me if they respect play action. Look at those linebackers sprinting downhill. If that were play action, they're out of position. But they are flying. I mean, they're at full sprint by the time Watley has the football in his hands.
They crowd the line on second and 12. They jumped it. It's a free play. They flip it downfield. Leaping catch made by Smith Marset. Looks like Penn State was offside, and this is going to count. Down to the Lions, 37.
How about the adjustment?
Offside, defense. That penalty's declined. Result of the play is a first down.
How about the adjustment by the true freshman, Smith Marset, getting able to go matched up against Christian Campbell, a true freshman at 6'2", 175 pounds out of Newark, New Jersey, just gets the ball off before Miller gets to him, adjusts back, makes a circus catch, and it's a big gain for the Hawks.
He made a diving catch to win it, an overtime road victory over the Cyclones. Wadley has a little bit of a crease, loses the ball. A scramble for it, and Penn State's got it. A turnover just when Iowa's offense finally had mounted a drive. And Grant Haley, who's a big play corner, came up with it.
And it's the extra effort there, and Marcus Allen, the veteran safety, eventually is able to dislodge the ball. The effort right here, the spin move, and then watch two right there. Perfect hit. Ball is out before his knee touches. And then Penn State with Haley, who always seems to be Johnny on the spot, comes up with a football.
Allen and Haley are a big play combo. It was Allen who blocked it, Haley who returned that blocked field goal for a touchdown against Ohio State. The win that really started Penn State on this run.
And think about Haley, the stop he had in that Big Ten championship game last year as well. He's always making big plays.
Saquon has the edge, breaks another arm tackle, still going. Into Iowa territory, cuts it back. Saquon Barkley getting loose now in the third quarter and showing he was brilliant.
How did he stay in bounds? How about the left foot just stopped? You're gonna die when you see this. He's on the sideline. Watch his left foot just stop on a dime right near the sideline, just right. As Jewel comes in, boom, he just stops immediately.
Was the knee down though? Was the knee down? Penn State playing fast, and there's not going to be no review. I mean, Sorley flips it, and finally it's Gesicki, the tight end, getting involved. The crowd booing because I think the Barkley's knee might have been down on that run.
Where he put that left foot in the ground, the right knee looked very, very close. The officials did not make a decision to slow it down. I just want you to appreciate how fast he does this. Watch this. He's full speed, and he puts his left foot right there. I mean, how does he do that? It's incredible.
He's Saquon Barkley.
Yeah.
Hard to tell from that. It's a 44-yard gain. We'll get a breather as Miles Sanders comes in. He's got the football. And Sanders, he's got quickness too. Cuts it back. Retreats a little bit, but does get the edge. And run out at the 21.
That's what I'm saying. When you bring in Robinson or Sanders or Allen, Penn State very, very fortunate to be able to have such depth there. And
see the
smile
from the superstar there?
He's like, good job, man.
His backup makes a nice run.
Good job, buddy.
But Sanders' quickness on his own, the sophomore, a very heavily recruited guy at high school.
You lose Superman, and you think it's going to be a significant drop-off. But, of course, you don't have another Saquon Barkley. My point is these other backs that they have are very, very talented.
They've had very few touches, actually, combined, because Barkley has been so busy in the first four games. Delayed handoff. Saquon works between the tackles. Another solid first down gain.
Offensive line with a nice push. Good surge up front by this O-line. From the time James Franklin and his staff got into State College till where they are now as a program, I would argue that the area that they've improved the most and where there's the most improvement in the depth would be on that offensive line. They were playing walk-ons when they first got there, and now you've got a legitimate Big Ten offensive line and some depth.
87 combined starts between them. They get the right guard man back. And now McSorley fires incomplete. A bullet off the hands of Juwan Johnson.
I tell you, man, it is tough coverage right now with Jackson, the way he's covering.
Did you watch tape? Did you think the corners of Iowa would hold up as well?
Yeah, I really did. This is not a fluke. I mean, they are aggressive. They're long. Jackson is a junior out of Texas. He is outstanding. He's really come on this year. And Rugumba, 5, after being suspended the first game, you knew it. We saw him in his first start last year against Michigan. They got two great corners. Gesicki's the matchup concern, the tight end, but he hadn't had a catch tonight.
On 3rd and 6, McSorley delivers, and there is Gesicki on cue, Kirk, at the tight end, able to get knocked down at the 10 by Neiman. He is such a weapon, but they've been patrolling his area tonight.
But he's been taken away for the most part, but this time they're able to find him.
A little rub,
but they get him out. He's 6'6", 250 pounds. Good effort there to be able to pick up that first down.
So Iowa's defense once again backed up, trying to force Penn State to a field goal attempt. First and goal. Barkley with blockers. It is run out for no gain. Rugumba, that corner you're talking about, stayed at home.
Yeah, so this entire secondary has played well tonight. We've talked a lot about Rugumba, Jackson, Amani Hooker has also made some plays, 27. Just a great effort on that back end. The big, big focal point was, do not give up the big play. Don't let anything get behind you. And they've kept the ball in front of them. They're making Penn State earn it. If Penn State gets out of here with a win, they will have earned it. It's not the big plays that's hurt the Hawkeyes tonight.
See the red zone futility so far for Penn State. Option look, Barkley. Diving. Knocked out, just shoved out short of the goal line. Thanks, touchdown. Excuse me, a delayed signal. I thought they were going to spot him short, but Saquon Barkley and Penn State finally find the end zone.
As
check
he's
this again.
Going out of bounds, watch the ball. He's going to go out of bounds, but before he touches, I think the ball breaks the plane. He's still in. Right there.
Very close. The crowd doesn't like the call. Is it cross the line before the foot hits out of bounds? Looks
that's,
like it.
That's a touchdown.
Just.
That looks like a touchdown to me.
That ruling is under further review.
What's amazing, Kirk, besides all the other attributes that he has, he's got a presence of mind. The game happens very slowly for him. There was a touchdown against Pittsburgh where he spotted a Pittsburgh defender's shadow. He saw the shadow on the field, figured out that he needed to change direction, and just ran away from the shadow. Now, that's
awareness.
That's next level stuff.
You know, we keep talking about all his lifting and all the training that he does. I don't know if he's doing yoga, but when you're running with all your momentum, with the balls in your right hand, and you have to somehow bend back over to the left and get the ball across the pylon before you go out of bounds with all that momentum going. Talk about his flexibility.
Right, you can build all that muscle, but it doesn't mean a lot if you can't bend and move, and he certainly can.
It's like you in the hot yoga class, stretching
not
it out.
Not exactly like me in the hot yoga class, which I don't do, by the way. I'll let you have the joke. If it stands, it'll be Barkley's fourth rushing touchdown, or the first touchdown tonight for this offense.
Dave, you think that's a touchdown, sir?
The way it looks here, I think they're going to have to stand on it. The ball appears to break the plane right over the top of the pylon before that foot touches down in bounds.
After further review, the ruling on the field of touchdown stands.
Not confirmed, but stands. And finally, the Penn State touchdown. And an extra point to try to stretch the lead to 8.
Can only hold out
exactly.
Saquon Barkley so many times in this Penn State offense.
On his 24th touch offensively tonight, finally a touchdown.
Averaging 10 yards a carry, by the way, tonight, too.
I know, it seems like the Iowa defense done a great job. Number 26 still making his hay.
Saquon Barkley's don't come around very often. I've been doing this for 23 years at every level. I've never seen anybody like him.
Barkley in this quarter has 100 yards rushing on 7 carries. 9.6 a carry, Kirk. As a receiver, 7 for 47. He hurt Iowa badly last year in the win, setting up for an even bigger night tonight. Kelly Martin,
tries to give the Hawkeyes some good field position, and he will, with great determination, get the ball out across the 30. Crowd appreciates that effort. Next week on Saturday Night Football, presented by Wells Fargo, we are headed back to one of our favorite spots, Kirk Lane Stadium, Blacksburg, Virginia, as Clemson comes calling. Tigers pulling away at home against Boston College. It was 7-7 late third quarter. Eventually they got going. We'll see if the magic of Lane Stadium can give the Hokies inspiration next Saturday. Clemson's got it going. In Louisville last week.
Justin Fuente doing a really good job in his second year in Blacksburg. And I think Clemson, somewhat of a predictable, a little bit of a lazy day today.
You guys made a call on game day yet?
I don't know. Bear might know.
Hokie fans are eager for that answer. So now down 8. Hawkeyes back to work. And they fake it to Wadley. And finally, a downfield shot on first down. Incomplete. Diving attempt. It's picked off. Grant Haley. We're going to confer here. They're going to confer. And one official does say yes. Penn State football.
Yeah, I think he got his hands underneath that. His elbows underneath to come up with that interception.
Off the hands of Easley.
But this is the call. Play action. Right call.
Accepted.
Stanley puts the ball up too high. Obviously, Easley, who's not the tallest, they list him at 5'11". He tries to go up and make a play on the ball. He's open. They just miss it. And then how about again? Grant Haley, always in the right spot. See if he's able to secure this.
The ball can touch the ground as long as you secure it.
That's
in
an
the
interception.
Hands.
The crowd doesn't like it, but that's a pick.
We'll bring in Dave Kataya again. You need to take a look at this. We're looking at it. Okay. Bottom line is that bottom of that ball tip hits the turf, and the ball appears to move. Watch that. Watch the tip of the ball hits the ground. Now, does the ball move? They're going to have to determine whether that tip pushes the ball up and allows them to get control.
You make a determination. My determination is that that's an interception.
But the ground cannot aid in any control of the football, right, Dave? It cannot. And, you know, this appears, they're going to have to look at it with their quad and everything. This appears that that he lost control of that ball when that tip hit. Whether they have enough to say that is another question, but you can see the ball move. Tom Kissinger is the replay official for this Big Ten crew. He traveled with O'Neill to all the games, and he has input, but it's the booth that'll make this determination correct. So ruled an interception has to be strong, indisputable visual evidence to change that call, but whatever the ruling is, a tremendous effort by Haley is hoping that that's his third pick this season. One more look. Does the tip of the ball make it move before it's controlled?
And I don't know.
The key is 100%. 100% that it's wrong. That's what indisputable to you means. 100%. Not 98-2.
No.
100%. Beyond any
Is that 100% to you?
The problem is, Kirk, the ball moves,
and I don't think
he has control of it.
Okay, so you're saying that's 100%?
It's awfully, awfully close. They're slowing it down. You can see the ball move. It would not surprise me if they reversed this call.
But again, it's super close.
And this is an enormous play.
Huge play. Penn State just scored a touchdown up by 8. This would give Penn State the ball in Iowa territory again?
I don't know, Kirk. I do think that the tip of the ball
moved. After further review, the ball hit the ground, which makes it an incomplete pass. As a result, it'll be second down, 10 yards to go.
Wow, Dave, great call, buddy.
Those are tough.
Those are tough
ones. It's a slow first half. We knew Kataya was going to get involved after halftime.
Yeah.
But that avoids back-to-back turnovers for this Iowa offense. What would have given Penn State the ball in plus territory yet again to try to add to the lead.
Great play call there by Ferris. Execution just off. Ball just floated a little bit for Stanley, and that's what gave Penn State the chance to almost come up with that interception. But if the execution's there, that's a big game.
So second and 10.
This is why he's changing the call. He feels a blitz coming right here from Farmer.
And he's right. They change it to a run the other direction, and Wadley is forced out across the 35. All right, Kirk, you want to make the big announcement? It's official now, Hokie fans.
Beautiful. College game day headed to Blacksburg. Boy, we've had some great game days in Blacksburg over the years. Think about that. One time when Michael Vick was there.
It's one of the spots that helped build the show to what it is in terms of the road show. Frank Beamer.
Yeah, the entire home stands. Like 18, 20,000 people one time out there.
And then the magic of a Lane Stadium night game at primetime on ABC.
That's awesome.
We need four and third down. Vandenberg motions in. Stanley steps up but cannot escape. He's going to be spun down right near the line of scrimmage by Curtis Cothran, the big senior tackle. Fourth down.
That's great coverage. They rush four and drop seven. Bang zone. Look at that push. The pocket kind of collapses. And I think Stanley, just again, some of his inexperience sitting in that pocket, getting a little bit uncomfortable, had a tight end kind of breaking free over the middle, but just wasn't able to see him with that pocket closing in on top of him.
C.J. Beathard, last year's quarterback, more of a scrambler. Stanley has rushed for a total of gained 12 yards rushing coming in. He's no running threat at all. The lefty, Rastetter, kicks it away. This is a nice Iowa roll, dead at the 16. Monday Night Football. Dak Prescott and the Cowboys. Carson Palmer and the Cardinals. That is one of our favorite stadiums in Glendale. Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's at 6 Eastern on ESPN. The game also streaming on the app and in Spanish on ESPN2. Or ESPN Dos.
Remember you asked me at the beginning of the second half, what are they going to do with McSorley? And we knew that they'd be getting Saquon Barkley even more involved and just kind of continue to do what you do. There's nothing you need to necessarily change, and that's really worked for them these first couple drives that they have the ball in the second half.
Yeah, Barkley has been the hot hand. They feed him again. Saquon, a little sidestep in traffic and another terrific chunk of yards on
the
first
down. The problem you have is as a safety or linebacker, you've got to accelerate up to the ball carrier, Barkley, because he is so strong, you have to hit him with some speed. And when you come at him fast and you're going to try to hit him hard, he's able to olay you and work around you. So it makes it real hard because if you come in soft, he'll run over top of you.
Surely from the pocket flips it to Gesicki. He was knocked down by Rugumba. First down yardage. Big guy has not gotten loose tonight. You can see some frustration in the tight end's game right now.
Yeah, and you know he had a chance possibly to head out to the NFL, decided to come back.
Tremendous athlete. He was a basketball player, volleyball player, 6'6", with great hops. He's the unofficial dunk contest champion of this football team. Barkley again on first down, escapes. And Saquon rips off another nice first down game. Here's your guy, Gesicki. Starts off kind of basic, just a windmill. Gets better. Swiss. I mean, he could have been a great volleyball player. Could have played a little hoops in college. But has a future as an NFL tight end. Still developing as a blocker, but he's a strong dude. He could put up some weight group numbers himself. Not quite Saquon, but not that far.
He had a nice block on that last play. You're right, he is trying to improve that area. Just help Barkley get some yards.
McSorley steps up and escapes the pocket. Has a first down, has much more. Flags come flying in as the quarterback slides down at the 42-yard line.
And it's going to be a hold on Penn State. Irvin Charles.
They're looking at about the 42-yard line of Penn State as the spot of the foul.
Holding. Offense number 11. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat, second down.
And you're right, Kirk. It is Charles. 23-yard gain negated.
Charles just trying to pick up a block on Josh Jackson to free up his quarterback. He's already pretty... About 15 yards downfield.
Yeah, pretty obvious call.
Yep.
So after the spot foul, moves it back to second and five. And it's Mark Allen, number 8, in the ball game for the first time. They motion him out. McSorley, again, steps up. Downfield, catch made. Deshaun Hamilton, they're fighting and spun out in Iowa territory by Taylor at the 45.
Great execution that time by McSorley and the timing perfect with Deshaun Hamilton. actually makes that throw before he gets out of his break and gives him a good move to the inside. Ball is in the air now. You can see with Rugumba running with the receiver downfield, it opened up a nice alley towards that left sideline.
With a pair of 23-yard receptions, so he's within eight of Deion Butler's all-time reception record at Penn State. Saquon gets these one-play breathers, and he gets right back in there, right? He takes the pitch and just runs to the boundary for another big gain. And it's just 8 yards, 8 yards, 8 yards on first down.
There's a flag down here on this one.
Personal foul. Illegal block below the waist. Offense number 70. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat, first down.
They got the experienced guard, Brendan Mann, on penalty.
He's trying to get out in front and make a block right here on Jewel. Just submarines him. He's got to get him from the front, not the side. That's why that was called.
So a couple of penalties on Penn State's offense, negating productive runs. Ball moved back to their 45. The second down and about 20 in the final minute of the third quarter. Should be first down and 20. Surly pump fake and delivers a short one to Gesicki. Keep him in front of him, and even though he gets Iowa territory, they'll take that, Fowler and Jewel combining.
Yeah, so the game plan is still the same for Iowa. Just try to keep everything, especially in the passing game, in front. Sit back and as much as you can play zone and then rally to the football. You know, that part of the defense, among other things, they've done a great job because the ball's been so deep in their territory, but just not giving up the home run ball through the air. They've given up yards to Barkley, but not a lot through the air.
Barkley in as a protector, but McSorley's hit. Ball comes out. Fumble, and Iowa's got it. A.J. Epinesa, the true freshman. The rule of fumble. They'll check it.
Recovered by the defense. First down.
Josie Jewell, who else, recovered his second takeaway tonight.
Chris, how about the speed off the edge from this true freshman? I mean, he's going up against some grown men and going right around them with just speed.
They don't get many recruits like that at Iowa.
No.
And Kirk Ferentz remarking, making sure that it was a fumble, did not look like his arm came forward.
Yeah, was the arm coming forward?
The arm was coming forward, but he looked like he lost possession and did not have secure possession when the arm was coming forward. Take a look at this where the defender makes contact. 5 seconds to go. I was going to keep the ball. And now, finally, a downfield shot on first down. And here comes an interference call as Penn State suddenly flag prone. It was Christian Campbell defending Vandenberg.
It's almost like Iowa was holding
defense
on.
Defense number one.
A little double move here by Vandenberg. Like they're holding on to some of these plays that maybe they were going to call earlier, and now they're going to maybe reach into that bag of tricks and try to take some shots downfield and try to challenge Penn State vertically.
So it's going to be an untimed down here before the quarter ends. Campbell getting that right arm across the receiver. And the ball moved to the Penn State 40. And you're right, Iowa just finding a way to hang around. Penn State mistakes with the penalties and the fumble, giving the Hawkeyes life once again.
Remember, the whole thing with Penn State, or with Iowa, is all plays together. The defense, the special teams, the offense, the crowd, try to get within a possession in the fourth quarter and find a way to win the game.
Offset eye. Wadley on a delay. Spin move. Wadley just caught from behind at the 20. Brandon Smith made a saving tackle, but the final quarter will begin with the Hawkeyes in the red zone.
Finally, to see 25 with a little bit of room to run. Penn State brought some pressure. There's a spin move. 25 saying, I know Barkley's a bad man, but give me a chance.
End of three. Back after this word from your local ABC station. Set for the final quarter on Saturday Night Football, presented by Wells Fargo in this presentation of the Big Ten on ABC. Iowa off the controversial takeaway. We'll show you another look at that. Begins the fourth quarter at the Penn State 20.
Ivory Kelly Martin is the back. And Stanley trapped and unable to throw it. And Kirk, let's take another look at this play. Epinesa, as we check with Dave Kitai, Epinesa got a hand in. Dave, give us the ruling on the arm coming forward with control of the ball.
He has to have complete and secure control with forward motion. Right here, you see the defender touching the ball. The ball starts to wobble. He sort of shot puts it forward. He's got to have complete secure control. Remember, to reverse it has to be 100%.
So you back up the call of a fumble there.
At that point, but they should have stopped and looked at it.
Agreed. After the loss, it's second and 14. Stanley again feeling some pressure, fires downfield and over the head of TJ Hawkinson, the tight end. Crowd wants another interference as Campbell was again defending. There is no flag.
I think the crowd's reacting to look like maybe a jersey hold. And again, we keep going to Dave here, but Campbell's in coverage. Usually with the head of the defender is an indicator. If his head is looking back, he's able to have that hand fighting. That's where he grabs the jersey. And see, Dave, there he peeks there at the end. What do you think of that?
Well, Herbie, I think you're absolutely right. He's not looking back, and he grabbed the jersey. I think it was a foul.
Yeah.
Doesn't take much when you grab and twist a jersey to throw it.
Well, if your head's looking back, they're going to give you a little bit of wiggle room.
No call, and it's third and 14. Stanley. Looking, delivers a low throw, catches good to Kelly Martin, but well short of a first down. It'll be fourth and about eight here, and here comes the field goal team.
So big for Iowa just to be able to come up with points here. Obviously down by eight, get the big break, they get the turnover, they're in Penn State territory. And
Keith Duncan, the kicker that beat Michigan here a year ago, we were here in the walk-off field goal. He was beat out by this guy. Miguel Vecinos was the long-distance kicker. Now he's doing all of the kicking duties. His first attempt tonight from 36. And it's blocked. Penn State once again gets a hand and a field goal. You've heard this before. And the special teams make a big play, and it's Troy Apke, the safety, jumping around.
But Apke, a special teams guru right here, is able to fight off the edge, gets airborne, and then is able to get his hands on it. Kabinda, 40 in there too, but it was 28 Apke who actually blocks the kick.
He's lobbying for the block. Yeah, I think you're right. He did get the left hand on it. So Iowa, empty, still down eight. Off the field goal blocked by Troy Apke, Penn State to work from the 20, protecting what is still an eight-point lead. Option again, Barkley. It's an outside move, trying to make a big play. Could not escape Ben Neiman.
Yeah, what a night for Saquon Barkley. Already 182 yards on the ground. A lot of yards after contact like this. On just one carry, there's 21 yards. The quickness, the lateral quickness to go with that lower body strength and the balance. This is just an amazing run where he just puts his foot down, stops, full speed. Put down, stops, and is able to use that balance and agility.
McSorley delivers a strike on the far side. It's Juwan Johnson.
I don't know, it's way, way, way too early, unless you're on SportsCenter, to talk about Heisman. But
yes, it is. I agree.
But, my gosh. I mean, are you kidding me? It's going to be interesting to see if Penn State has a great year, which you would expect them to have. Who in the world is going to beat that guy for a Heisman Trophy?
No one at the running back position. A few quarterbacks maybe will put up some big numbers.
I don't know, man.
Mason Rudolph taking a shot today, a loss to TCU for Oklahoma State. It's third and two. Surly very deep in the shotgun. Picks his way. It will be stopped right at the line. Ball's out. Ball is out. An offensive lineman has it. So Penn State, with Ryan Bates, the tackle, coming up with McSorley's second fumble tonight. The Lions have to kick it away.
Third and two. They take Barkley out of the backfield, so you know McSorley's going to keep it. And Parker Hesse is right there. We haven't called his name much tonight because of Nelson and some of the others, of course, the linebackers, but Barkley taken out over the slot. McSorley runs it, and the Hawkeyes are all over it.
It's a nasty scrum there. You don't want to know what's going on there. Big fellas fighting for the football.
Somehow Bates ends up with a ball.
Yellington to punt. Yeah, Bates was in there like a bull in a china shop, banging into his quarterback, then coming up with the fumble. And Aubrey Martin is forced out at the 30-yard line. Iowa with the football back, still down 15-7.
Saturday Night Football on ABC is presented by Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo, building better every day. In part by Pacific Life, experience the power of Pacific. And the Home Depot, more saving, more doing.
Pacific Life game summary, Penn State reclaiming the lead with a 10-point third quarter. Big night for Saquon Barkley. Josie Jewell with two takeaways leading an Iowa defense that's kept the Hawkeyes close despite a lopsided total yardage category.
Yeah, if you look at every stat that there is to look at, you would think that this is a pretty decisive lead right now for Penn State, but still a one-possession game. Hawkeyes have got to get something going here with 11:32 to go in this game.
Wadley finally got a little something going on the last possession, but again, nothing doing on that right side. Parker Cothran and Christian Campbell off the corner.
Yeah, Campbell came on a blitz. Again, took away the edge, and the way Penn State's playing on first and 10, still, even into this fourth quarter, just not a lot of room for Wadley to run.
Lions defense that should be fresh. Iowa has run just 40 plays tonight. Complete reversal of roles. The Nittany Lions have dominated the time of possession. Motion in the tight end and hand it to Wadley, who's got a little space in the left side, but it'll set up third down and six.
Third and six with a quarterback who hasn't been real comfortable right now in the pocket. Wouldn't be surprised. Maybe you move him away from some of the pressure. Brent Pry on the other side, a defensive coordinator. Does he rush four and just drop seven? Does he bring a little bit of a blitz, try to create some confusion? Remember, the big tight end, Noah Fant, is a great target, guy that they want to try to get the ball in these kind of situations.
He's really been held in check tonight. Well covered. Apke, the safety, is up covering him. Stanley looks the other direction. It's Wadley out of the backfield. Wadley's in the clear. Akram Wadley cuts back. Heading to the end zone. Touchdown, Iowa. Yards and 70,000 are suddenly awake. So, 2-point conversion away from tying the game. And finally, an explosive play from the guy from New Jersey. He's been waiting all night.
And it's great to see him with room to work. One of the quickest backs in the Big Ten. We've talked so much tonight about Barkley. I really thought before this game started, we'd have every other opportunity to be able to start talking about Akram Wadley. And finally, he gets a chance to get out in the open room with a chance to make some people miss.
Iowa attempting a 2-point conversion for the first time tonight. Or the first time this season, I should say. Trying to tie this at 15. Ivory Kelly Martin is the back with Wadley needing a rest after that long run. Lions bring pressure. Stanley delivers under pressure. High throw. Incomplete. Tried to get it to the tight end. Hawkinson broken up by Apke. Here's the touchdown again.
Gutsy call here on third down. Penn State brought the blitz. Right here is Cam Brown, an outside linebacker. They're also going to bring Jason Kabinda. The problem is, in man-to-man, nobody picks up Wadley, and that's why he gets free. Stanley recognizes it, just checks it down quickly, and now when you give him the ball quickly like that, he can make Nick Scott, the safety, miss, and now he's out into the open space with a chance to make people miss, and with that speed and quickness and the nose for the goal line, he's going to get to the end zone.
It's a great look for Kabinda, realized too late. Oops.
Exactly.
That was my guy. Then a teammate knocked him over in pursuit. Here's the 2-point play again.
Yeah, this is a really, really tight throw. Not a whole lot of an opportunity. He got his hands on the ball, but you got two different defenders able to just swat that football away. Pretty good effort by Apke from behind to knock the ball loose.
It was the man who burst in to block the field goal, breaks up that two-point try. And Penn State clinging to a two-point lead. Barkley again deep, looking to make an impact as a returner. Why not? Than everything else tonight. Sinos drives it to the one. And Saquon penned in very well and knocked down short of the 12-yard line. Perhaps just a little bit weary for the first time tonight after all those touches. Talked about the electric atmosphere a week from tonight in Lane Stadium. Enter Sandman, all that stuff before the game, and we'll see if the Hokies can feed on that. They'll be underdogs at home against number 2 Clemson, which got going late today against Boston College.
That will be a great atmosphere with the defending national champs.
About to get loud now.
Coming here into Blacksburg. Yeah, about like this right here.
Penn State desperate to avoid a third turnover tonight. Barkley on the delay. Escapes and scoots for about 9. Offense only had 2 turnovers in their first 3 games, and one of the best turnover ratios in the country. Number 2, in fact, coming into this game, but -1 so far tonight.
Yeah, and it's because of what we're seeing with the relentless pursuit and effort from this attitude of Saquon Barkley. Just when you think you have him bottled up, if you're on the backside, you better not give up when 26 has the ball, because he could easily be coming your way with his vision.
He's approaching 200 rushing yards. Got it again. That time knocked down short on the first down yardage. Matt Nelson, one of the backup tackles, made a nice play. Yeah, third and very short now.
Yeah, that time they are getting off of blocks. Matt Nelson does a good job of being able to kind of use his arms and his length to be able to push his offensive lineman off of him. Brandon Mann. Kind of a 2-gap technique where he's looking into the backfield, uses his long arms, sheds the blocker, and is able to keep Barkley short of that first down.
The old days, Kirk, this would have been I formation with a fullback lead. They don't have any fullbacks on this team. 26 figures to see it, and the offensive line misfires, and Penn State now will be facing a 3rd and 6.
Offense number 70, 5-yard penalty, still 3rd down.
Second penalty on Mann tonight, the veteran.
Man right here, just a little bit of a flinch. Chris, Kinnick Stadium, you just said it's about to come alive. This is why the Hawkeyes do what they do in this stadium. This is why teams that are highly ranked come in and get into a game that's 15-13 in the fourth quarter. Now you got to deal with the crowd.
Makes early from the pocket on 3rd and 6. Flips it backwards to Barkley. Hurdles a man and makes a first down. What did you say before? Superman? Come on.
It was like he jumped right over it. It was the only thing that was left for him to do. I mean, that was it. What else is there? By the way, he takes a hit and lands. He lands it. Not only does he go over Jackson, Amani Hooker drills him as he is going down. And he's like, I'll just, no problem.
We're talking
I'll absorb
that. How do tackle this guy? You got to go low, right? You can't hit him in the 5.
You have to.
And Jackson did that, and Barkley had an answer.
Put an asterisk next to that 3rd down conversion.
Good point. It's Robinson now in for Barkley. He takes the pitch, and a short gain to the boundary. You're exactly right. If Penn State has to punt, Iowa gets the ball back down 2.
You're talking field position. You're talking clock. Yeah, I mean, that is a big, big 3rd down. And when he dumped it behind him, it was almost like a lateral. It gave him more room to accelerate. It was as if it was predetermined that we're going to hurdle this defensive back.
What's going on? He's at a 2-play rest now. He's over 200 yards rushing. 2nd and 4, they leave Robinson in the game. And McSorley wants to throw. Pump fake. And delivers into traffic. Coming back for the ball is Johnson. It's a 1st down catch.
That little pump fake, the corner blitzes. You're going to see the blitz, but the pump fake out here opens up the throw to the outside. Watch the blitz by Jackson. Pump. Now it opens up really nice throwing alley for him. where he's able to come up with another first down to his guy, Juwan Johnson.
He hasn't had enough time to pump fake very often tonight.
No.
Clean pocket for a change. And Saquon back in there. Yet another carry. Nowhere to run initially, but Barkley finds a way to make 7 yards out of nothing. Which is what the offensive line says. That's why they left the block for him.
And that's why I'm saying, if you're playing this position, you've got to get out here. You've got to be really careful of collapsing down. You collapse down and you lose the edge to the defense. And all of a sudden, oh, he's just waiting and waiting and waiting. And he's hopping. And then he finally finds a little bit of a hole.
I want to count the cuts on that one. How many cuts was it in that run? Four?
And it's 7 yards.
Second and three, it's a one blitz. McSorley, a late pitch. Barkley trying to again escape and does fight for a positive yard. It'll be third down.
It's one thing to corral him. It's another thing to tackle him. I mean, you think you've got him, but he's able to kind of maneuver around. Again, when you combine that acceleration and quickness with the power.
It's a two tight end look for Penn State as they need 2 yards here. Barkley battling. It'll be close. The spot may be just short at the 42. Cedric Lattimore on the tackle. And now, Franklin, a decision here. They'll measure this, I believe, based on that yellow line, maybe a little bit short. So what do you do here, Coach?
Wow, that's a...
Isn't that a tough one? It's right there.
One. Yeah, it's a tough one, but I think they have a lot of confidence in their offense.
I mean, they have a lot of confidence in the running back.
Yeah, and I think with 5:51 to go.
It is tough, though. If you fail here, you're given high with the football, pretty near midfield, down just two. You can tell he's
talking about it. Talking to both his coordinators. They're going for it. There's the defensive coordinator right there, Brent Pry. He's talking to Joe Moorhead. Says, let's go for it. We're here to win.
And you're right. 5:51. You move the sticks again. You begin to bleed the clock away.
You got to think 26. Barkley's going to get the football here, right? Last time they were in a third and short, they had him.
That's why you have this
they
position.
They had him flanked out, and they ran McSorley.
That's why you have this position that you do it professionally.
You got to run it.
Well, Johnson is running on late. There's some confusion here.
James Franklin is talking. He's getting guys on and off the field.
They bring in another tight end. Fourth down. Less than a yard.
Timeout, James Franklin.
I wanted to get a look, perhaps, at Iowa's defensive set and think about this crucial play. We'll take a break as Franklin ponders. Away from the four wrap-up show with Cassidy Hubbard. Penn State off the timeout. Needing less than a yard on fourth down. Can the Hawkeyes defense make yet another short yardage stand? Who else? And Barkley able to muscle for a first down inside the 40. No mystery. It's still hard to stop.
Yeah, you just knew Barkley against Jewel since the beginning of the game. Good against good. Jewel's trying to read it, trying to be able to get penetration, but really, really tough to slow down. Saquon Barkley with the line getting a pretty good push. Hooker coming down to try to help out. Now Penn State taking their time, not in a hurry at all. Working the clock and trying to come up with points on this drive.
But if it's only a field goal, Iowa has a chance. Get a
feeling that they find the end zone, Buckeyes in serious trouble. Saquon spins out of a tackle in the backfield. And gets around the right edge, stays in bounds after about a 7-yard gain.
Sean Brinks, at 275 pounds, had his right shoulder. He grabbed him. It looked like he lost his balance. It's because 275 pounds grabbed onto him. And instead of going down, he kind of gathered. And then, of course, jumps around the right edge and picks up positive yards.
It's a new career high for Barkley. He rushed for 207 against Purdue last year. See how much of the play clock they use. After a 7-yard first down gain, it's Robinson. He snap it at 10. And Robinson hammers close, but not quite, the first down marker. Third and short again.
We've seen a mix of Robinson and Miles Sanders tonight when Barkley has needed a little bit of a breather. Back now into the end of the lineup. I keep looking at him and just thinking, it's so rare to see a back that's built the way he's built, who is so elusive and just so difficult, slippery to try to bring down.
I feel like they may have two plays to get this. It's fringe field goal range right now for Tyler Davis. Brown tries to make it tough. They clock it three. McSorley rolls and flips it to Barkley in the flat. It's a race. He slips as he wants to make a cut, but it's a first down at the 15.
Penn State is going to kind of use a little bit of a rub here to get him freed up to the outside. Man to man. Watch the receiver right there. He gets in the way of Jewell, the linebacker, who had Barkley man to man. As long as that receiver is making it look like he's running a route, it's not going to be called a pick. Does a good job getting in Jewell's way, and Jewell had no chance to get out into the flat to take down Barkley. Great call there by Joe Moorhead. Well designed.
Wear and tear evident after 336 all-purpose yards. He's looking at that left ankle. Nine receptions to go with these 28 rushes. Keeper. Thought about throwing it. Didn't want to go out of bounds. Forced out there by Rugumba.
Take a look at Barkley. He's been taking, you know, a play or two off and then coming back in. This feels a little bit different. And this is a big, big sequence of plays for both these teams at this point in the game. Hawkeyes have defended that goal line all night incredibly well.
13th plays already, 76 yards, inside of 3 minutes now. McSorley cannot escape. Dragged down for a short loss, and it'll be third and long.
This defensive line has been relentless, just never giving up. That was a combination of good coverage, and see Barkley still trying to stretch it out. But great coverage, but also that defensive line never giving up and eventually getting to him.
Buckeyes spend their first timeout. Northwestern Mutual bringing you this week's rankings. Big Ten East with three teams in the top 10. If Penn State escapes, you don't feel like the top five should change. Those Buffaloes, 7-0 on the Huskies in Boulder.
Yeah, Oklahoma State losing to TCU. The Horned Frogs are going to jump up big this week.
Big play here. Nittany Lions need 8 on third down, or it's going to be a field goal attempt.
Barkley obviously back in the lineup here.
You got a breather with an Iowa timeout. They retape that left ankle. It's a shovel pass, and Saquon, no gain. Once again, Josie Jewell sniffed it out, and it's fourth down.
Boy, how much fun is he to watch? He's up into the trenches. He's up here. He's ready to blitz, but watch him. He's going to show blitz, and then he gets off of the potential block by Steven Gonzalez, recognizes the pitch, and is able to come in and make the play.
We talked about Jewell in the open. Here's a dude who thought he was going to play Division III football at Luther so he could stay close to home, work the family farm. This is beyond his wildest dreams, starring for the Hawkeyes. Fourth year, really, as a senior starter. He's led the team a couple of times in tackles.
How about the night he's had?
That's just business as usual for 43, huh?
But this game, where they have been, have time after time, series after series, the Hawkeyes have turned to Phil Parker in this defense, Josie Jewell, and said, guys, come up with another stop. Come up with one more stop. Keep us in this game. And for the most part, they've been able to do that.
Tyler Davis has not been automatic. He's a little inconsistent. If you watch practice, he's had a very solid career. Made two chip shots tonight, missed from 41. This is from 31. Very, very important kick. Difference between 2 and 5. And it's blocked. Iowa comes up with its own field goal block. Anthony Nelson, that long arm defensive end. Hawkeyes still down only 2. 2:42 to play.
Yeah, he's on the right side right over here. And with that length at 6'7", able to shoot a gap. Shoots a gap at 6'7", 260. Thing he had to do is be careful not to run by it. Good job. The right hand knocks that down, and the Hawkeyes have a chance. Now, a field goal, if they get in the field goal territory, could win the game for Iowa.
It always has to come down to a field goal at Kinnick Stadium.
Absolutely. If you're a top five team, that's part of the rule, I think. You come into Kinnick Stadium, you better be ready. Last second field goal.
It was Keith Duncan with the walk-off 35-yarder to beat Michigan here a year ago, a similar type gang. He's lost his job, and Miguel Recinos may have an opportunity. Stanley throws downfield for Fant. The tight end wasn't looking, but now a flag comes in. Marcus Allen saying, what do they do? It's going to be interference on Penn State.
Well, Fant wasn't even looking for the football.
Pass interference. Defense number 2, 15 yards from the previous spot.
Chris Allen grabbed a hold of him. He grabbed a hold of him. You'll see it. Watch 2. He grabs a hold of him, but Fant's not even thinking about the football. Definitely grabs a hold of him there.
You say, well, it's not catchable. Well, you get a lot of latitude on that call, because if you grab a guy's jersey, you impede his progress, you're going to get that call. So it moves the ball to the 35. That's exactly what the Hawkeyes needed to jumpstart this possession. Pressure. Stanley. Complete. Here's a short gain on a crossing route to Smith Marset. And Iowa's beginning to build some momentum.
This is what Nate Stanley and Brian Ferentz, the offensive coordinator, they've worked on this throughout camp. Build confidence in being able to work the 2-minute drill. Still have a timeout. Just need the field goal.
In the pocket, Stanley delivers wide open. Van de Kamp knocked out of the 35, and the Hawkeyes fringe field goal range right now with 2:11 to play.
Wow, a free release. Doesn't allow the safety to get over. By being able to get behind the corner, Campbell does not do anything to slow Vandenberg down. Look at this. He gets right behind Campbell. Campbell needs to get his hands on him. Otherwise, the safety has no time to come over and make that play. Fell asleep.
22-yard gain, clock running inside of 2. Lions crowd the line, but Wadley's got a crease. Akram Wadley. Bye-bye. Iowa takes the lead. It takes just a minute and 3 plays to go 80 yards for a go-ahead touchdown. 35 yards by Wadley. He's watched Barkley shine on the other side, and finally in the second half, Wadley has gotten free for a couple big plays. 70-yard reception, a 35-yard touchdown run.
Charge timeout, Iowa. Their third and final timeout.
Chris, Penn State is out of position with their linebackers and safeties. Watch how they kind of communicating, trying to make sure they're on the same page. At the last second, they move to the right. And by moving to the right, there's nobody left to the left for the offense. And once the defensive line is separated, the linebackers and safeties are gone. They're all aligned to the other side. And Wadley has such speed. Once he got into the second level, there's no one there. And there he hands the ball to the official after last week where he high-stepped it in.
So Iowa up by 4. Keeps the offense on the field to again go for 2. They build to a 6-point lead. 2 Iowa touchdown drives in the fourth quarter. This offense had been dormant, penned in all night. 74 yards in 3 plays, 80 yards in 3 plays. This has been a complete role reversal. It's Penn State grinding away methodically. Iowa striking quickly, barely having the football. Completely dominated and outgained all night. A monster night by that guy, and suddenly Penn State down 4.
Remember, minute 42, 2 timeouts, a lot of time for Penn State.
There's the 2-point try. Stanley flips it high, and no chance for anyone to make a play. Just airmail it out of the end zone. So the lead is still 4, a minute 42. Talked about the history. The last 3 top 5 teams that have come in here have been beaten, including Penn State on a field goal in 2008. It was a beatdown of the 5th-ranked Spartans 2 years later. And, of course, the primetime game, Keith Duncan with the walk-off winner, 14 the hard way for the Hawkeyes. Looked like we were setting up for another field goal. Trying to take the lead when Wadley breaks free, and now suddenly a field goal does Penn State no good.
This is going to have a different feel from those other upsets, because now it's the Hawkeye defense. It's been asked to do a lot tonight. Do they have one more stop in them to be able to secure this 50 victory, or can Trace McSorley and Saquon Barkley come up with the plays that they need to get that touchdown to possibly win this game for Penn State?
Wadley, a guy that is not in Ferentz's doghouse every, so that's overblown, that's completely inaccurate. His teammates love him, positive attitude, always has a smile on his face. Coaches love him too. So Barkley not back there. Miles Sanders, fresh legs on the return, out to the 20. Reminder, the All-State all-hands-in bus is helping find great teamwork and great work in the community all season long. Who's the team of the week?
Yep. Each weekend we pick our team of the week. The All-State All-Hands team this week is TCU. On the road at Stillwater, 44-31. How about Darius Anderson, 160 yards on the ground. Makes some big catches as well, the 3 touchdowns. You can see it's their first win in Stillwater since 1991. Congrats to Gary Patterson and the Horned Frogs.
And now Trace McSorley. He was deeply disappointed by that close loss at the Rose Bowl. Wants to use that disappointment as fuel this season. Has a chance to rally Penn State from behind by 4. From the pocket, McSorley flips it short. Catch made by Juwan Johnson, who breaks free. First down across the 30. They can save a timeout there.
Yeah, save the timeout, pick up the first down. Again, McSorley has been in these kind of situations, has the 2 timeouts.
Again, ball batted down at the line. One more time, Iowa gets a hand up. Parker Hesse made that play.
Well, everybody seems to be taking a turn on knocking the ball down tonight from Trace McSorley. Who will be the guy that's going to have a chance? All night it's been Saquon Barkley. But in these kind of situations, he can catch it out of the backfield. But Juwan Johnson, Gesicki, which one of these receivers can beat man-to-man and get away and get some separation?
McSorley trying to escape, drops way back and just heaves it into the bench. Did he get outside the tackles? We're going to have a conversation whether this is grounding or not.
Well, that's the question. Did he get outside of the tackle box?
There is no foul for intentional grounding. The quarterback was outside the tackle box and the ball made it to the line of scrimmage.
Right here is your tackle box, and once he gets outside of that, he's clearly outside of that. As long as the ball goes beyond the line of scrimmage, it doesn't matter.
3rd and 10. Low snap. McSorley steps up, delivers. Barkley dragged down short of the first down by Josie Jewell. One more chapter in that duel tonight. And a timeout. Franklin will spend it with 58 seconds. 2 yards short on fourth down now.
I mean, Josie Jewell has been asked to do everything tonight, trying to stop Barkley. And this is the toughest thing you can be asked to do, is be able to play against him man-to-man in the pass game. I mean, you're out there in space trying to take Saquon Barkley down, staying close enough to him in coverage that when he makes the play, you got to be able to get in there. Now you got to tackle him. It's one thing to cover him. Now you got to tackle him, and he does it again to set up this fourth down.
They may have to tackle him one more time. We'll see if they look to another playmaker or feed number 26. Hawkeye defensive chance to finish the game, win it right here.
You know, Joe Moorhead is a very innovative thinker, and as good as Barkley is, you wonder, can you use him in any way as kind of a decoy to get the defense out of position to maybe go to another guy and be able to make a play? How much does Barkley have left in the tank? 28 carries, 11 receptions.
He's broken the school record for all-purpose yards. To him, it won't matter unless he can get two more yards here.
Iowa tight two, pressing the line of scrimmage.
McSorley to throw. Caught. First down. Saeed Blacknell in traffic, and the Lions have life at the 46.
How about the throw and the catch? Gutsy call. He has had so many of those throws in that area knocked down by that right. Iowa defense. He steps up and makes the throw, and a great catch as well by Blacknell.
Brock moving again. 45 seconds. From the pocket, McSorley escapes and has a lot of room and slides down. First down yardage. They'll stop the clock briefly at the 42.
And again, he's going to hold on to that timeout, looking over, getting the call from the sideline. The two backup quarterbacks signaling in the call for everybody, not just McSorley. And Penn State ready to go. They saved the timeout.
Inside of 30 seconds. McSorley looking to escape again. Flips it downfield and is caught. Johnson got behind the defender, shoved out at the 24.
How about Juwan Johnson improvising? Keep your eye on him. He kind of runs a hitch and then just kind of gives up on it. Then he sees his cornerback in trouble. He takes off behind the corner, finds that little opening. Great recognition by McSorley to find to make the throw for the first down.
24 seconds to work with. McSorley flips it at the last minute. Barkley still running and scoots out of bounds at the 10. Made a man miss. 15 seconds to play. Got away from Jewell that time.
And he saves the timeout by getting out of bounds. Here's the matchup. Jewell and Barkley one-on-one. It's been all night. Why not one of the last plays of the game? Shake right there. Gets by him and he's able to pick up about 5 or 8 more yards. And as I said, he gets out of bounds, so they don't have to be in hurry-up mode.
Got to take an immediate timeout if you're tackled in the field to play for Penn State.
Or the sack.
First and goal. Throwing the far sidelines. Gesicki makes a catch. They use 4 seconds and get about 3 yards.
I think that was really, he wanted to get the ball to Johnson downfield. It was taken away. So instead of throwing it away, he just flips it out to Gesicki for a couple yards.
How great is this? Iowa's defense, Penn State's offense, it's been the battle all night.
All night. And this is where the ball's been all night.
Yep.
And Iowa has won their fair share of these battles. What happens here in the final sequence?
McSorley has time, flips it near side, no chance to make a play. Tompkins very well covered by Rugumba. 7 seconds to go.
This is where Trace McSorley has got to allow the play to develop. He can't predetermine where he wants to go with the ball. That time, if he would have given Deshaun Hamilton the ball, he had a chance to get into the end zone, but he got locked in. Read the defense, make the right call, and flip the ball out. Juwan Johnson has the size advantage up top, one-on-one against Josh Jackson.
McSorley looking to the sidelines, making the adjustments. Play clock at 7. Crowd is deafening. Flip back. Batted down for the 6th time tonight. The Hawkeyes get a hand on it. It's Anthony Nelson. 4 seconds down to 1 play.
I think Penn State catches a break here by this ball getting knocked down. Actually, he almost comes up with the interception. I mean, for a big guy, but if Hamilton catches that football, he is tackled immediately by three different Hawkeye defenders, and who knows how much clock is left. So by being an incomplete pass, the clock stops, and it gives Penn State one last chance from the 7-yard line.
And an offense that has piled up 572 yards tonight on 98 plays. Tremendous balance, but has often stalled down inside the 10, needs 7 yards to avoid the upset.
I really like to watch Joe Moorhead work there as the offensive coordinator. How calm he is as he communicates with Trace McSorley and the rest of that offense. He's right here. Watch how he's just talking. He's talking to see Barkley now. Barkley's in that huddle, last guy. Why not, man? Why not get the ball to 26 somehow, some way, win or lose with Saquon Barkley right here?
You know, Mr. Jewell's going to be eyeballing him as well as his buddies. One play to decide it. McSorley across the middle. Touchdown! Juwan Johnson. Penn State wins it. A walk-off touchdown. Wow! An 80-yard drive in 12 plays, a minute 42. And Trace McSorley, cool on that final drive. It is a final. They have to snap it for a two-point try. But you just take a knee.
Wow.
And Penn State is going to avoid the upset trap on the game's final play.
What a game, first of all. Josie Jewell, Iowa, great effort. Trace McSorley, when the game was on the line, the last play shows he is a winner. This kid's been a winner since he's in high school. Led his team to 4 straight state championships. Watch this. I said, which receiver would eventually come up with the play? He works to the inside, a little outside move, and is able to get to the into the inside of the defensive back. Ball is thrown on time over the top of 27 Hooker somehow for the touchdown. And by the way, you know what Saquon Barkley did on that play? Picked up a blitz to be unselfish. We thought he might get the ball. Instead, he picks up the blitz to help his quarterback have more time.
It's a victory formation and a punt into the sky by McSorley. And a frustrated night for McSorley. He had an interception. He had a fumble. Heading for the touchdown pass all night, but does so for the 19th consecutive game in his last chance to do it.
Just an incredible game. Again, watch Barkley. He picked right there. He is. He picks up the blitz. How this ball gets over top of Hooker, 27, just gets over him into the hands of Juwan Johnson, who had beaten his man.
And Juwan Johnson makes his first career touchdown reception, a magical one to beat Iowa on the game's final play. Winner is right. And James Franklin, it was Saquon all night until the final drive when it was McSorley and the receivers getting involved. And let's go down to Maria Taylor.
Yeah, Chris, and now I'm down here with Saquon and James Franklin. And Coach, it wasn't easy, but it came down to 4 seconds and 4th and 7. What were you telling your offense before they took the field again?
Well, first of all, you got to give your hat off to Iowa. They played unbelievably well. The environment here was tremendous. So much respect. But, you know, our team believes. We've done this for 2 years. We believe. We didn't play the way we wanted to play today, but Iowa played unbelievable. They're playing a real soft defense. They made us earn it. I thought our defense was unbelievable. We had great field position. We just weren't able to get in the end zone.
What about the play by Trace? I mean, being able to step up and make the game-winning play. When things were not going well for you offensively, how was he able to pull it off?
Yeah, we had substitution at our tackle, and he was battling all day long, so the sacks was what really hurt us, the sacks, fumbles. But Trace is one of the toughest guys I've ever been around. He never stops believing, and these guys never stop believing in him either. This guy was unbelievable. I didn't get a chance to watch it from a fan's perspective, but from a coach perspective, I can't imagine there's a better player in the country than this guy.
All right, well, let's start talking to him then, Saquon. Over 300 yards of total offense from you in all-purpose yards. So what was working for you on that side of the ball?
We knew Iowa was a physical team. They're known for being a physical team and stopping the run, but we wanted to set the tone on our offensive line. And our offensive line, like every week, did a tremendous job setting holes up, not only for myself, for Trace and all the other running backs. And we were able to get the run game established. And like Coach said, they were playing soft. They weren't really giving us anything deep. Made it earn everything. And Trace did an unbelievable job of going through his regression and coming down and getting checkdowns. And I was able to make some guys miss and get some yards.
Making guys miss. Not only that, you were jumping over guys. Take me back to that third down conversion. When did you see the guy coming, and when did you know that you were just going to hurdle a defender?
It was third down. Critical moment of the game, and Coach Huff always coaches that you got to get the third, you got to get the first down, and whatever you got to do, whatever it takes. And sometimes you just, your body let go, you let go, and you let God. And I was able to get over a guy and break another tackle and get the first down and get the drive, keep going.
All right, you had a lot of carries today. We saw you walking off a couple times gingerly. How is your body feeling right now?
My body feels great. We just won. I'm super excited. Like Coach said, I got your credit to Iowa. This whole environment, they were tough. It's what they're known for. We came here, respected that, and they were tough. And Iowa defense played a great game, and the offense played a great game, and it was a great game overall.
All right, congrats on the win.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Maria. Sunday in an ice tub after a school record for all-purpose yards. How about McSorley on that final drive, Kirk? 7 of 11, 68 yards. And finally throws a touchdown pass tonight, also ran for 12 yards.
You know, you get challenged like this on the road, and Iowa gave Penn State everything. You get challenged, and you're a championship team. You've got to come up with an answer, and Trace McSorley was able to find that answer with the last play of the game.
Everything they had to avoid the upset trap tonight. 21 the hard way. A couple field goals, a safety, and two touchdowns, including a walk-off touchdown pass, McSorley to Johnson. A classic at Iowa City, 21-19. Hope you enjoyed it. It was produced by Bill Bunnell, directed by Derek Mobley. Next Saturday night, we'll see you in another magical environment. Blacksburg, Virginia, an ACC battle. Clemson and Virginia Tech, 8 o'clock Eastern over on ABC. Time now for the Ford Wrap-Up Show. Take a deep breath and send it to Cassidy Hubbard.